The committee will come to order. Without objection, the Chair will be authorized to declare a recess at any time. The Oversight Committee exists to secure two fundamental principles. First, Americans have a right to know that the money Washington takes from them is well spent. And second, Americans deserve an efficient, effective government that works for them. Our duty on the Oversight and Government Reform Committee is to protect these rights. Our solemn responsibility is to hold government accountable to taxpayers, because taxpayers have a right to know what they get from their government. It is our job to work tirelessly in partnership with citizen watchdogs to deliver the facts to the American people and bring genuine reform to the Federal bureaucracy. This is and has been our mission for 4 years that I have been honored to serve. Ms. Tavner, before I begin with my opening statement, I want to make you aware, in hopes that your people will deliver documents pursuant to a subpoena that expired, or didn't expire, that was due 8 days ago, related to the documents behind your coming before this committee and giving false and misleading testimony related to the so-called 7.3 million enrollment figure. We asked for and we received only half of the documents, and the documents that were excluded were the ones that created the talking points and the people who caused you to use inarticulate language that carefully allowed you to say 7.3 million without disclosing that that included at least 400,000 dental plans. That was subpoenaed. It was clearly understood. Last night we received a huge data dump, and it was not in there. And it makes it very difficult for us to go forward with some aspects of today's hearing. As you can imagine, it is clear that this hearing in no small part was not because of what Obamacare is about, not about the health care. It is about honesty and transparency to the American people. Today's hearing is likely the last full committee hearing of this Congress. This committee has a primary obligation and has lived up to that obligation to look at government, to make government more transparent and accountable. And at times, members on both sides of the dais have helped in trying to create that transparency. But no government program needs increased transparency and accountability and honesty more than the Affordable Care Act, known as Obamacare. It has proven time and time again to, in fact, have made false claims. Every member on both sides of the dais can agree that the Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare, is a large, expensive program reliant on a complex network of government programs which significantly impact the lives of all Americans. And yet the history of design passage and implementation with the law is fraught with half-truths and deceptions. Here are just a few of the false claims the administration has made regarding Obamacare. If you like your doctor, you will be able to keep your doctor, period. Nothing in Obamacare forces people out of their health plans. No change is required unless insurance companies change existing plans. Health care inflation has gone down every year since the law, Affordable Care Act, has been passed, and that it now has the lowest increases in health care cost in 50 years. To that we add, we have got close to 7 million Americans who have access to health care for the first time because of Medicaid expansion. If you like your plan, you can keep your plan. When trying to pass Affordable Care, Obamacare, the administration repeatedly claimed that the law's individual mandate was not a tax. However, months after passage, in a brief defending the mandate's constitutionality, the Justice Department argued just the opposite, that it was a tax. One of our three witnesses this morning offered a simple answer to this change in position.
This bill was written in a tortured way to make sure CBO did not score the mandate as taxes. If CBO scored the mandate as taxes, the bill dies. Okay? So it was written to do that. in terms of risk-rated subsidies. If you had a law which said healthy people are going to pay in, it made explicit that healthy people pay in and sick people get money, it would not have passed. Okay, just like the people, lack of transparency is a huge political advantage. And basically, you know, call it the stupidity of the American voter or whatever. But basically, that was really, really critical to getting the thing to pass. And, you know, it's the second best argument. Look, I wish Mark was right. We can make it all transparent. But I'd rather.
I wish he was right and we'd made it all transparent. Professor Jonathan Gruber is considered by many as the architect of Obamacare. As a former Obama administration official put it, Professor Gruber was the man on Obamacare, the guru of health care, the official we went on to say, I remember that when I was at the White House, he was certainly viewed as an important figure in helping to put Obamacare together. No one can look at the amount of money he was compensated for his work in Obamacare, totaling millions of dollars, and think that our witness was anything but a critical player in the Affordable Care Act. Current administration officials, however, have attempted to distance themselves from Professor Gruber. Ever since he stated and started telling the truth about the tactics used to pass this law. In fact, the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services urged the committee not to seat him with the administrator next to him. And Dr. Gruber, we think you are right to be there. In fact, we believe that this is a perfect pairing, a pairing of individuals who are, in fact, responsible for what we know and don't know before, during, and after the passage and implementation of the Affordable Care Act. September 18, 2014, the Administrator, Ms. Tavner, came before us and testified that, in fact, there were 7.3 million people enrolled in the, and I quote this carefully, health insurance marketplace coverage. That tortured language had not previously been used, and it followed a series of document requests after we were told, trust us, the numbers are good, in which we discovered that, in fact, 7.3 million would have to include a fairly large 400,000 individuals in more or less $50 dental plans. Obviously, when you say you met a goal and the difference between making a goal and not making a goal are plans that nobody would consider a key element of the Affordable Care Act. HHS initially failed to provide any documents to explain how the numbers had been interpreted. On October 1, 2014, the committee requested the enrollment data underlying Tavner's 7.3 million enrollment announcements. Our requests were met with delays, runarounds that bordered on obstruction. After weeks of negotiation, CMS finally provided the enrollment data printed on spreadsheets with, and for those who are at my age will appreciate this, 6-point font, something that is not readable even with your reading glasses. When electronic copies were demanded and the data was finally delivered, oversight investigators discovered that all of the hundreds of spreadsheets were, in fact, password protected and locked. After further negotiation, we finally were able to receive the passwords and recognize that all along there had been an inherent deception. This was quickly discovered and would have been discovered by anybody simply by putting the spreadsheets in ascending order of dollars. On November 21, 2014, only after it was publicly noted, the committee discovered the administration was willing to acknowledge 393,000 dental plans in the figures released in September. Moreover, HHS included dental plans in its enrollment figures not just once, but twice. The agency has included dental plan in its November enrollment figures and has now been forced to revise down to not greater than 6.7 million enrollees. The administration claims it made a mistake. However, there is great skepticism about that, and particularly the term mistake, when it appears as though instead HHS and CMS were too clever in an attempt to inflate the numbers and say they'd met a goal. It is a small technical error in many ways, whether you had 7.3 million or 6.7 million, if in fact it's simply a matter of whether you made a goal or didn't make a goal. But when you doctor the books, add additional numbers, and then use careful language so that you didn't lie, but you did deceive, that is exactly what we are concerned about here at this committee. The American people have a right to know the honest numbers. Management has an obligation to know it if they are, in fact, going to be accountable to the taxpayers for doing their job, and, in fact, the American people expect no less. Professor Gruber is often said in Washington to be the definition of a gaffe. That's when somebody accidentally tells the truth. You made a series of troubling statements that were not only an insult to the American people, but revealed a pattern of intentional misleading the public about the true impact and nature of Obamacare, which is in many ways you helped craft. Today we'll have an opportunity to ask you to apologize for your low opinion of the American people, and hopefully apologize for the false information on which the analysis of what the Affordable Care Act would do was built, leading to the disappointments we see here today. And with that, I would recognize the ranking member for an opening statement. He is not here. All members will have 7 days to submit opening statements for the record. We now go to our panel of witnesses. Ms. Marilyn Tavner is the Administrator of Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services at the Department of Human Services, and Mr. Jonathan Gruber is a professor at MIT. Mr. Massey would probably normally introduce him, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Pursuant to the committee rules, all witnesses will be sworn in before they testify.
Chairman,
would you please both raise your right hands? Stand and raise your right hand
to
take the oath. Just a moment. I'm going to go through where I am, please. Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you are about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Please be seated. Let the record reflect the witnesses have answered in the affirmative. Please be seated. For what purpose does the gentleman seek recognition?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At this time, Mr. Chairman, in the absence of the ranking member, may I ask that we have a minority witness, Mr. Ari Goldman, for whom we thank your indulgence. And we would ask for convenience sake, since we have a small panel here, that Mr. Goldman be added to the panel and be sworn in and testify at the same time.
You know, I appreciate your suggestion. He is not a government witness and not an expert in any of the facts being discovered today, so we will leave him on the second panel. But I thank you for your suggestion. Ms. Tavner, you are recognized for 5 minutes for your opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I appreciate the opportunity to appear here today and answer your questions about CMS's continuing work to provide affordable, high-quality health care to the Americans we serve. In my previous...
Ma'am, I appreciate it. If you just pull the mic a little closer. Thank you. Sorry.
In my previous appearance before your committee, I reported a number of Americans that were enrolled in Marketplace coverage and had paid their premiums that included both medical and dental coverage. Simply put, this was a mistake. Some individuals with both medical and dental coverage were counted twice in the individual affected enrollment numbers. Moving forward, only individuals with medical coverage will be included in our individual affected enrollment numbers. We are now providing weekly snapshots of the 2015 Marketplace data, including the number of consumers who have submitted an application, contacted the call center, or visited the website. We have also created a new data office and have named our first chief data officer. This new office will help CMS strengthen its processes and, more broadly, will help CMS better harness and use our vast data resources to drive better care at a lower cost. While this mistake was regrettable, it should not obscure the fact that the Affordable Care Act is working. We have 6.7 million Americans enrolled in health care coverage and paying their premiums as of October 15th, and the number of uninsured adult Americans is down 26%. Since the beginning of the open enrollment period, about 9.1 million additional individuals have enrolled either in Medicaid or CHIP. For the first year of a new program, this is a tremendous accomplishment. 2015 open enrollment is off to a solid start. Because of new choices and more competition in the health insurance marketplace, many consumers are now able to shop and find even more affordable options in the second year of the program. We have seen a 25% growth in the number of issuers participating in the marketplace, which means that more than 90% of consumers will be able to choose from at least three or more issuers, and over 60% of the marketplace enrollees are able to renew coverage at their metal level for less than $100 a month after tax credits. Those already covered should come back to the marketplace to review their options for next year. People may find an option that is either more affordable or better suits their needs. We've improved the consumer experience as well. The shopping and enrollment process is simpler, faster, and more intuitive for consumers. With the new streamlined application for many consumers, we've reduced the number of screens from 76 down to 16, with fewer clicks to navigate through the questions for most consumers. Consumer interest is strong. Since open enrollment began last month, there have been over 765,000 plan selections, 48% of which are new consumers. Over 1.5 million applications have been submitted, and there have been more than 5 million website visits. But the Affordable Care Act is not just about coverage. In recent years, we have seen historically low growth in overall health care spending. Just last week, CMS's Office of the Actuary released their 2013 health expenditure report, which at 3.6% is the lowest reported growth in health expenditures since this report's inception in 1960. While the recent slow cost growth has multiple causes, reforms to the Medicare and Medicaid programs are meaningful contributors to these gains and are improving quality as well. For example, preliminary estimates indicate that hospital-acquired infections fell by 17% from 2010 to 2013, resulting in 50,000 fewer admissions and over $12 billion in cost savings. I'm proud of our progress at CMS. I'm proud of our team. They work hard every day to ensure better, safer, and more affordable health care. Thank you, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you. Before we go on, I would recognize the ranking member for a unanimous consent request.
Chairman, one of our members had requested that we have an additional witness to come on the panel, and I would ask that unanimous consent that ask the Chairman to allow that to happen.
Okay. Are there any objections?
I object.
Would you reserve for a moment?
Sure.
Let me ask the witnesses. Ms. Tavner, do you have any objections to having, I understand he is a waiter at a local restaurant who thoroughly loves Obamacare. He's actually an independent consultant. I apologize. They gave me a new title. Do you have an objection to Mr. Ari Goldman, an independent consultant, being on a panel with you?
I have no objection.
That's good. He likes your stuff. Mr. Gruber, do you have a problem with an independent consultant being on the panel? Then I have no objections. Does the gentleman continue to reserve?
I withdraw my objection.
Okay. Hearing no objections, while they seat Mr. Goldman, I would ask the ranking member, since he was unavoidably detained, to do his opening statement, and then we'll go to you, Mr. Gruber. Mr. Cummings.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Before I begin, I know today is your last hearing, and as Chairman of the Oversight Committee, and I want to thank you. As you said a few moments ago, we have taken this journey together, and it has been a great journey. I said during your hanging of your portrait right there.
Thank you for saying I was hung.
That I believe that everybody who comes along your path comes along your path to make you better. And I will tell you, Mr. Chairman, you have made me a better person in so many, many ways. And I want to thank you. I want to thank you for your service. I want to thank you for your dedication. I want to thank you for taking the time to get to understand these issues in a very, very intricate way. And a lot of people have not been in the many meetings that we've sat in where you, I don't know how you do it, but you seem to be an expert on so many, many things. And I know it's because it is your passion. And so I thank you. In a way, I wish we had last week's hearing on the Data Act today, because it was such a positive note for bipartisanship, and it showed what we can do when we work together. I also want to thank you for inviting our witness, Eric Goldman, who is here to testify about his own personal experience obtaining health insurance after we passed the Affordable Care Act. I would like to welcome you, Mr. Goldman. And so, Mr. Chairman, I know we may disagree today about the Affordable Care Act, but I hope we will do it in a respectful way based on substance and the evidence before the committee. In 2010, Democrats in Congress passed the landmark Affordable Care Act to give millions of people across the country health insurance. We banned insurance companies from discriminating against people with pre-existing conditions. We established significant new measures to hold down health care costs. And we provided extra assistance to those who needed it. Today, based on the evidence before us, the ACA is working. Millions of people are now covered through the exchanges and Medicaid expansion. And according to the New England Journal of Medicine, the rate of uninsured has dropped by over 4 percentage points since last year. That is a 26% reduction in the ranks of the uninsured in just 1 year. The evidence also shows that the ACA is bending the cost curve. The growth of national health care spending decreased to 3.6% last year. That is the lowest rate on record since the 1960s. In addition, reforms of health care delivery methods have saved $12 billion by reducing the number of hospital-acquired conditions. Despite these clear benefits, Republicans have spent the last 4 years doing everything in their power to repeal the Affordable Care Act, dilute it, undermine it, and impose it. This has become one of their chief political goals. They have taken 53 votes to repeal or weaken the law. And last year, they shut down the government for 16 days in a failed attempt to delay its implementation. In our committee today, we will hold our 29th hearing on the Affordable Care Act. That is a stunning number, more than 24 hearings, but not one, has helped to implement the ACA more effectively or efficiently. It pains me to imagine the good we could have accomplished had we devoted that same amount of time and resources to more constructive efforts. And so I mourn what could have been. Unfortunately, this hearing is no different. As far as I can tell, we are here today to beat up on Jonathan Gruber for stupid, I mean absolutely stupid, comments he made over the past few years, and then drill and grill Administrator Taverner about what appears to be an inadvertent mistake in reporting ACA enrollment numbers. This may be good political theater, but it will not help a single American get health insurance. It will not help a single person get well. It will not help a single person get the care that they need. Let me be clear. I am extremely frustrated with Dr. Gruber's statements. They were irresponsible, incredibly disrespectful and did not reflect reality, and they were indeed insulting. I was in Congress when this law was debated, and Dr. Gruber does not speak for me or the chairman of the other committees who worked tirelessly on this bill. We debated this legislation for nearly a year before it was finally passed and signed by the President. We held 79 hearings and markups in the House of Representatives alone. Never once did I believe or did anyone suggest that we were somehow hiding our goals from the American people. But worst of all, Dr. Gruber's statements gave Republicans a public relations gift in their relentless political campaign to tear down the ACA and eliminate health care for millions of Americans. Many Republicans now allege some kind of Democratic conspiracy, citing the praise for Dr. Gruber's work from President Obama and other Democrats. But that, too, is completely wrong. Let me highlight some additional praise Dr. Gruber received for his work. Dr. Gruber received the following thanks for his contributions to health care legislation, and I quote, "Jonathan Gruber at MIT devoted hours and hours to an essential economic model." That statement was not from President Obama, but from the Republican nominee for President in 2012, Mitt Romney. He thanked Dr. Gruber personally at the signing ceremony for the Romney Care in Massachusetts in 2006. A day earlier, Mitt Romney wrote an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal entitled, "Health Care for Everyone, We Found a Way," end of quote. This is what he wrote, and I quote, "Jonathan Gruber of MIT built an economic metric model of the population, and with input from insurers, my in-house team crunched the numbers," end of quote. Governor Romney said this, and then I said this too, quote, "Because health insurance will now be affordable and subsidized, we insist that everyone purchase health insurance from one of our private insurance companies, and so all Massachusetts citizens will have health insurance. It's a goal Democrats and Republicans share, and it has been achieved by a bipartisan effort through market reforms," end of quote. And as I close, this is exactly what the ACC was modeled on and was supposed to be. But Governor Romney was wrong about one thing. That goal was not shared by Republicans in Washington. For the last 4 years, House Republicans have been trying to repeal the ACA, but they never explained what they would replace it with. What they would replace it with. In a few weeks, Republicans will control both houses of Congress, and they will be out of excuses. Governing responsibly does not mean eliminating essential health care protections for our constituents, all of our constituents, with no alternative. It means promoting the health and economic security of millions of Americans who desperately need help. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you for your courtesy. I want to thank you for your service to this committee, and I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. I would remind all members that the committee's jurisdiction does not include any changes to the Affordable Care Act other than those involving transparency and reporting, and that the committee's jurisdiction and its 29 hearings have been related not to whether we like the Affordable Care Act or not, but in fact, whether or not we are getting the transparency, proper reporting required for which this committee is known. With that, I would have to ask Mr. Goldman to please rise to also take the oath. And raise your right hand, please. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you are about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Please be seated. Let the record reflect that our third witness has answered in the affirmative. Dr. Gruber, it is now your turn. Thank you.
Chairman Issa, Ranking Member Cummings, and distinguished members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify voluntarily today. I'm pleased to be able to address some statements I've made regarding the Affordable Care Act and the reaction to and interpretations of those statements. I'm a professor of economics at MIT. I'm not a politician nor a political advisor. Over the past decade, I've used an economic microsimulation model to help a number of states and the federal government assess the impact of health care reform on health care systems, government budgets, and overall economies. I've had the privilege of working for both Democratic and Republican administrations on health care reform efforts. I worked extensively with Governor Romney's administration and the Massachusetts legislature to model the impact of Governor Romney's landmark health reform legislation. I later served as a technical consultant to the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and provided similar support to both the administration and to Congress through economic microsimulation modeling of the Affordable Care Act. I did not draft Governor Romney's health plan, and I was not the architect of President Obama's health care plan. After the passage of the ACA, I made a series of speeches endeavoring to explain the law's implications for the U.S. health care system from the perspective of a trained economist. Over the past few weeks, a number of videos have emerged from these appearances. In excerpts of these videos, I am shown making a series of glib, thoughtless, and sometimes downright insulting comments. I apologize for the first of these videos earlier, but the ongoing attention paid to these videos has made me realize that a fuller accounting is necessary. I'd like to begin by apologizing sincerely for the offending comments that I've made. In some cases, I made uninformed and glib comments about the political process behind health care reform. I'm not an expert on politics, and my tone implied I was, which is wrong. In other cases, I simply made mean and insulting comments which are uncalled for in any context. I sincerely apologize for conjecturing with the tone of expertise and for doing so in such a disparaging fashion. It's never appropriate to make oneself seem more important or smarter by demeaning others. I knew better, I know better, I'm embarrassed, and I'm sorry. In addition to apologizing for my unacceptable remarks, I'd like to clarify some misconceptions about the content and context of my comments. Let me be very clear. I do not think that the Affordable Care Act was passed in a non-transparent fashion. The issues I raised in my comments, such as redistribution of risk through insurance market reform and the structure of the Cadillac tax, were roundly debated before the law was passed. Reasonable people can disagree about the merits of these policies, but it is completely clear that these issues were debated thoroughly during the drafting and passage of the ACA. I would also like to clarify some misperceptions about my January 2012 remarks concerning the availability of tax credits in states that did not set up their own health insurance exchanges. The portion of these remarks that has received so much attention lately omits a critical component of the context in which I was speaking. The point I believe I was making was about the possibility that the federal government, for whatever reason, might not create a federal exchange. If that were to occur, and only in that context, then the only way that states could guarantee that their citizens would receive tax credits would be to set up their own exchange. I have a long-standing and well-documented belief that health reform legislation in general, and the ACA in particular, must include mechanisms for residents in all states to obtain tax credits. Indeed, my microsimulation model for the ACA expressly modeled for the citizens of all states to be eligible for tax credits, whether served directly by a state exchange or by a federal exchange. I'm not an elected official, nor am I a political advisor. I'm an economist who ran a complex microsimulation model to help Republican and Democratic politicians and their advisors understand the impact that their policies would have on health care systems. The recent response to my comments at academic and other conferences exceeds both their relevance and my role in health care reform. I behave badly, and I'll have to live with that. But my own inexcusable arrogance is not a flaw in the Affordable Care Act. The ACA is a milestone accomplishment for our nation that has already provided millions of Americans with health insurance. Our country is embarking on an exciting second open enrollment period that will provide new opportunities for these individuals and millions more to choose the insurance plan that works best for them. While I will continue to reflect on the causes of my own insensitivity, I hope that our country can move past the distraction of my misguided comments and focus on the enormous opportunities this law provides. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Goldman.
Thank you, members, especially Chairman Issa and Ranking Member Cummings, for inviting me to share my story with you today. I'm one of the millions of Americans who, thanks to the Affordable Care Act, have been able to pursue goals free from the financial and physical implications of staggeringly expensive health insurance, or in many cases, no coverage at all. These reforms have helped ensure that many Americans won't have to weigh the crippling debt or something as simple as nutritious food for their children against access to even the most basic health care. I hope that my words today serve as a reminder of why the ACA, though imperfect, has measurably improved the well-being of individuals and families across the country. I grew up outside of Boston and stayed in New England for college. My 20s were a decade of exploration and change. In that decade, I had the freedom to switch careers twice, experience love and heartbreak, and revel in excitement and opportunity. At the same time, I watched friends become burdened with unforeseen medical emergencies and forgo access to preventative care. I am now 33 and have lived here in Washington, D.C. for 11 years. I am healthy. I have low cholesterol. I get plenty of exercise. I am doing pretty well. When I turned 26, I decided to abandon a nascent career in nonprofit fundraising. And this decision was bolstered by the unbridled optimism of a 20-something living in one of the most intellectually inspiring cities in the world. I didn't consider that because I have two very common and very manageable pre-existing conditions, I would be forced to navigate an intimidating and unfriendly health insurance marketplace. As I formed a vision for my next career, I found great satisfaction in making a living working in the restaurant industry. Although I worked full-time then at a restaurant with more than 50 employees, I was not offered any benefits. Undeterred, I ventured out into the individual market and applied to several brand name companies. And one after another, they turned me down. Ultimately, one company offered me a plan at about $450 a month. And disheartened from the prior rejections, I enrolled, even though they refused to cover any prescriptions or office visits related to my pre-existing conditions. I conducted a basic cost-benefit analysis and decided that I would rather be underinsured than not insured at all. My 2 years with this insurer felt like an unending, morbid, exceedingly expensive joke. Claims were routinely rejected due to processing errors, usually with no explanation. Still, it was better than nothing, and then I received a notification that, as of January 2014, my plan would be discontinued. So I'll admit that I wasn't looking forward to participating or to going forward in the process of enrolling through the D.C. Healthcare Exchange, as many other people agree with probably. But despite all the technical glitches and dead ends being reported by the media, I applied. I contacted a navigator at the Whitman Walker Clinic who referred me to a broker, and he answered the many complex questions I had about each individual policy that I was considering. With his help, and at no cost to me, it took just under an hour to sign up for a silver-level PPO plan, and in terms of premiums alone, this reduced my costs by 60%, which means I am saving over $200 each month. And I am able to keep all the providers with whom I have built trusting relationships with over the years. All my pre-existing conditions are covered, and over the past year I have had much lower day-to-day out-of-pocket costs to manage my conditions. I estimate that I have saved more than $5,000 in all, which in addition to my part-time work as a waiter, has made my decision to pursue my career as an independent consultant more viable. And I believe, and isn't that really quintessentially American? I mean, thanks to the ACA, I am able to be entrepreneurial and take control over my own future instead of finding and staying at an undesirable job because I can't afford to sacrifice my employee-sponsored health insurance. I no longer feel marginalized. I no longer need to resort to exorbitantly expensive yet woefully inadequate coverage. And later this week, I have an appointment with a broker to look into my options for 2015. And I have the confidence that I will be able to shop for a plan without fear of rejection or exclusion for coverage. I can do the research to find a plan that will meet my needs. So finally, when my old plan was canceled, I thought I was going to get similar coverage at the same cost, and I didn't expect it to be as good as it was. The unexpected thrill I felt after I enrolled was not only because I'm covered, but also because I'm participating in a part of history. And at the end of the day, I'm an ordinary man with a pretty good education and from a healthy family. So if the Affordable Care Act can help me, I believe it can help anyone. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Mr. Goldman, are you receiving a subsidy at all on that silver plan you chose?
No, I'm not.
Okay. Well, and I'm glad you found part-time work, even though in the past you found full-time work. Ms. Tavner, you testified before the committee, and you used the terminology enrolled in the health care insurance market coverage. Is that the appropriate and normal way you have always referred to enrollment numbers?
I don't know that I have an appropriate. I have called it the marketplace. I have called it health insurance coverage.
Well, that language allowed you to claim $7.3 million. Had you said enrolled in health care plans, you would have had to reduce that by at least $400,000. Isn't that true?
I think had I known that we had double counted the dental, I would have corrected that for the September hearing. As I said before, that was a mistake. And
No, I'm asking questions about the mistake. You gave what would be considered by anyone to be false and misleading testimony because you were given data that included 400,000 dental plans. CMS had previously released separate numbers, actually far greater numbers for dental at the time, and health care, and as those numbers went down, they got combined and the language got changed to enrolled in the health insurance marketplace coverage. So the question is, did you have anything to do with the use of that term, and were you aware, and it's a two-part question, each is a yes or no, were you aware that dental was included in your testimony?
I was not aware that dental was included in my testimony.
And were you in any way explained why the use of enrolled in the health insurance marketplace coverage was the term you read in your statement?
No.
Thank you. Mr. Gruber, I have been accused that I am going to berate you or something, and I hope that you won't feel that way when I get done. But night before last, I was at the Kennedy Center Honors, where they honored Tom Hanks, famously Forrest Gump, the ultimate in successful stupid man. Are you stupid?
I don't think so, no.
Does MIT employ stupid people?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay. So you are a smart man who said some, as the ranking member said, some really stupid things, and you said the same. Is that correct?
The comments I made were really inexcusable.
Okay. And I'll leave aside the political observations. But you did say in your in the video we played, and everyone else has seen, I think, parts of it, you did say that, in fact, if people knew the whole truth, they wouldn't have voted for this, that, in fact, the direction you were going, the reality, and specifically I want to talk, because Mr. Goldman is a poster child for this. He has a silver plan that is relatively inexpensive. If it was subsidized, it would be even cheaper. But the shifting of some people to pay more than they previously did, because remember, health care went up in price. So for Mr. Goldman to get a reduction, somebody else got not only an increase, but an increase to offset his decrease. That was what you were talking about. So isn't it true that, in fact, between the taxes and increases for some, that's part of the plan to reduce for people like Mr. Goldman?
First of all, I made a critical mistake in trying to conjecture with a tone of expertise.
Yeah, no, but you're an expert on the analysis of the numbers and where the cost shifting goes in your microeconomic analysis. And I'm asking you as Dr. Gruber, a smart man at a great institution that has collected over over $4 million in various fees and so on, your analysis, isn't it true that in order for Mr. Goldman to get his reduction, and he's very happy about it, that in fact there was cost shifting, including those so-called Cadillac plans? Isn't that true?
The Affordable Care Act set up insurance exchanges which pooled risks for the healthy and the less healthy. On average, when you account for the tax credits individuals received, people are paying less for health insurance than they
would. I'm a taxpayer, Mr. Gruber. Trust me, people are not paying less. People like me are paying more for those because taxes are, in fact, a cost that's paid. Total cost did not go down. Cost shifting occurred in your model. Isn't that true?
The amount that individuals have to pay for health insurance on average fell in my model.
Well, but it didn't fall in reality. Now, let me just ask one question, and this may be the tougher question for you. You said in these video comments that essentially you had to deceive in order to get this passed. Your models, the $4 million plus dollars that you and MIT received, including hundreds of thousands of dollars personally, to develop and to provide those models, if deception was part of the process by your own statements, why should we believe your analysis? Why should we not demand to go into the microeconomic analysis and find out whether, if, in fact, the $4 million in services you delivered were accurate or whether the books were cooked?
First of all, the amount of money to which you refer has been greatly overstated. It refers to grants that were received by research institutions and others, which I received a small fraction. Second of all, no one has ever questioned the quality or integrity of the modeling. The fact I made,
Mr. Gruber, I am questioning it in light of your statements, and that is why I am asking. Shouldn't we question or at least have independent analysis of the numbers you delivered before, actually to Massachusetts for that matter too, but to the Federal Government based on your statements that, in fact, if people knew the truth, they wouldn't, and that there was a deception in your own thing? And it's all I want. I want to go to the ranking member, but is there any reason that you would not approve the idea that there should be independent validation of the numbers you used in light of the statements that we've seen you made?
I think that the quality of my numbers should not be reflected by comments I made where I was conjecturing outside my area of expertise. At the same time, my modeling has always been very transparent. I've posted information about my model, and I'm happy to ask questions about the model, answer questions about the model and how it works.
Thank you. I hope that this committee and the next Congress will insist that there be an independent analysis of whether, in that fact, that model would stand the scrutiny of an audit. With that, I recognize the ranking member.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Gruber, as I mentioned in my opening statement, I was very frustrated with your statements. And I got to tell you, they were insulting. They were especially harmful because they gave the opponents of the ACA a PR gift. Man, you did a great job. You wrapped it up with a bow. This has nothing to do with the substance of this issue. It's just something critics will link to the ACA in future debates. Now, I have to say I listened very carefully to your testimony because I wanted to hear exactly what you were going to say. A lot of times, witnesses who come before the committee spin and avoid apologizing. So you deserve some credit, at least, for taking this head on and taking responsibility for your actions. I know you believe in the ACA, and you also worked with Governor Romney on his health care bill. Is that right?
Yes.
So my question is this. Sitting here today, what do you say to those people who are trying to eliminate the ACA and who are quoting your statements as a reason to repeal health care for millions of Americans and many of my constituents and people who are watching us right now on C-SPAN? Now, what do you say to them?
I would say that I made a series of inexcusable and offensive comments where I conjectured with a tone of expertise to try to make myself seem smarter by demeaning others, and I apologize for that, but that my flaws as a private citizen, not a politician, not a political advisor, my flaws as a private citizen should not reflect on either the process by which the ACA was passed or the success of that law itself.
Now, Administrator Tabner, you have been before our committee before, and I have complimented you on your efforts. And I do still believe that you are a great public servant. On November 20th, HHS reported that it had overstated the numbers of enrollees by about 380,000. The Chairman talked about that in his opening statement, and he just asked you about it. This was because HHS included people with dental coverage, too, and essentially double-counted them. How could that happen? I mean, you knew everybody, they know everybody's got a microscope on the program. So I'm just curious.
So it is a great question. It was an inexcusable mistake. And I think in looking at payments made, instead of unique individuals, we counted individuals who had both medical and dental. I believe we have put processes in place to prevent that from happening again. But it should not have happened the first time.
But you understand that the mistake has the same effect as Dr. Gruber's statement. Same thing. It gives ACA opponents a PR gift that they can use on cable shows and elsewhere to attack the ACC. It's an unforced political error. So now I have to ask you for the record, because everybody's going to ask you the same thing. You are under oath, and just tell me, did you intend to deceive this committee or the American people when you provided those enrollment numbers? Was that your intention?
I did not.
And do you have any reason to believe that anyone on your staff tried to deceive the American people, or was this error inadvertent?
I do not believe anyone tried to deceive the American people, and I believe the error was inadvertent. 6.7 million is a very large number. We are pleased with that number. This was an inadvertent mistake, for which I apologize.
As a result of the now, Mr. Goldman, I want to thank you for being here today, and I'm glad you're working, and I'm glad you're pursuing your dreams, and that's a good thing. As a result of the ACA, it is a fact that insurance companies can no longer discriminate against people like you, deny you coverage, or charge exorbitant rates because of your pre-existing conditions. How do you feel about that? And I think it's important for people to know what that means. You know, we hear a lot of times the negative stuff, particularly in this committee, but it's good to have somebody who has benefited from this. Can you tell us how that makes you feel?
Right. This isn't something I had thought about before all this, before I really left an employer that gave me benefits, because it wasn't something I thought was an issue. And I think I took that for granted, and I think a lot of people take that for granted. The health care coverage I had growing up and as a young adult in my 20s was great. And then when I decided to pursue something different, something of my own making, something very typically American, and I no longer had coverage, it came as a shock. So to suddenly have that inability to have my own little pre-existing conditions that many people have not be covered was a very strange and unusual feeling to me, and it was not a good one. So to be able to enroll through the ACA, and to still pay my part, but to know that I'm not being discriminated against based on something that millions of Americans have, it doesn't matter what they are particularly, it was a relief. And I didn't realize how much of a relief it would be until I actually got enrolled with a good health care provider as opposed to someone or a provider that provided inadequate benefits.
Just the last question. What was wrong with your insurance before you got this insurance here? You had previous insurance. Is that right?
Yes. My preceding insurance.
Yes.
Yes. Well, the premiums were almost twice as high, which in itself, it's a supply-demand issue, I assume. I'm not an economist, unfortunately, although I can make guesses. But I will say that the coverage I had, despite, regardless of how much I was paying on a monthly premium, was insultingly inadequate, and not just because of what it wouldn't cover, but because of how difficult it was to process claims and to how difficult it was to get any sort of response from the company itself. Prescriptions and doctor office visits related to my pre-existing conditions were uncovered, and that required a lot of out-of-pocket benefits. But also, even the stuff that was covered was very difficult to get reimbursed for.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And with the ranking member's indulgence, Ms. Tavner, I failed to only ask one thing. Can your staff provide any of the information related to the preparation of those talking points that was in the subpoena? That was part of what was asked for and not delivered.
So I know that we supplied some information to you late yesterday evening. I will go back and work with the staff to see what else we can get you. I'm trying to work with you.
Well, the discovery asked for information related to the false statement that was made by you, certainly inadvertently. You've called it a mistake, but we asked for the creation of it so we could see who created it, who put the numbers together. You know, it took a staffer 20 minutes to find the error once we got the passwords to unlock this. It wasn't hard to find. So the question is, and I'll be brief, do Can you ask your people, to the extent that it's already been pulled, and we believe if we issue a subpoena, it's already been pulled, our people worked with your people, they knew this is what we wanted, could we have it? Because we have people on both sides of the dais who don't have those facts at would be the last hearing of this year. So I appreciate that you want to get it to us in the future, but it's crippling to a great extent to have a hearing in which the main subject of the hearing, which is how did we get misled and who was involved in it in the process of creating those talking points, we don't have it. So the question is, can you instruct your people, to the extent that there has been any pulling of that documents, to get it over to us so that people down the dais can ask those questions? I know Mr. Gowdy likes working off of facts, not fiction.
Yes, sir. We will work with you.
Sure. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman. Just
yes, Mr. Cummings.
30 seconds. Mr. Chairman, one thing I failed to say, I wanted to, when I was complimenting you earlier,
taking any of that back?
Oh, no. I wanted to take a moment, Mr. Chairman, to express my deep appreciation and respect for your staff and for my staff. I know a lot of people will be moving on to new jobs, but these are folks that work night and day trying to present the very best that they can to this committee and to American people. And I take a moment to thank them for all that they have done. This is a key era, time in American history, and I appreciate it. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And because of your wise comments, I'm going to pile on just in one sense, Mr. Cummings. We do have the best staffs on the Hill. They do countless thousands of hours of deposition and transcribed interviews. They pore over more documents than any other committee of the Congress, and they're able to qualitatively search for and find in IG reports, in Freedom of Information reports, and obviously in working with whistleblowers, things that no other committee can find. And I think that that's a genuine statement for both sides. There's no better set of committee staff than what we are honored to have, and I thank you for bringing that up. We now go to the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Gruber, you have said that your statements were inexcusable and insulting. I certainly understand when someone gets caught saying something as inflammatory as what you have said, how you might want to recant it. However, some of the things that you said were substantive based, and although they may be inexcusable and insulting in that they were said, in the end, they may be true. And I want to walk you through some of the statements that you made that were substantive in nature rather than the statements that you made about the American voter. Now, you've said that you did complex micro-simulation modeling. It sounds like a relatively basic model to me. You take from one and give to another. It's a basic equation of wealth redistribution, and that's called a tax. And you've made many statements about the Obamacare plan as being a tax, and I want to go through those. Now, I want to remind you, this is not the casual conversation that you have had in the conferences where you have insulted the American voter. This is actually a hearing where you took an oath. You said on March 16, 2011, the only way we could take it on was first by mislabeling it, calling it a tax on insurance plans rather than a tax on people. And we all know it is really a tax on people who hold those insurance plans, a tax. On January 18th, you said if you are a state and you don't set up an exchange, that means your citizens don't get the tax credits, but your citizens will pay the taxes that support the bill, a tax. October 30th, in 2012, you said we just tax the insurance companies. They pass it on in higher prices that offset the tax breaks we get. It is very clear, you know, and that is when you went on and insulted the American voter as to the fact that they couldn't understand that basic equation. And then on October 17th, you said, this bill was written in a tortured way to make sure CBO did not score the mandate as taxes. If CBO scored the mandate as taxes, the bill dies. Now, I know, Mr. Gruber, that you believe that your statements were inexcusable and insulting, but they do appear to be true. You are not here recanting today your statements with respect to the tax aspect of Obamacare, are you?
I am here today to say that any conjectures I made about political
This
prophecy.
Is not a conjecture, Mr. Gruber. I mean, conjecture is, I believe it may have been, someone may have been thinking, perhaps they were, perhaps it was. This is your straight-up statements. These are not conjecture. Is it your purpose today to recant Obamacare as a tax?
It is my purpose today to come forward and elaborate and straighten out the interpretation of a series of comments that I made and to apologize.
Excellent. Let's do that then. Let's clarify it. Mr. Gruber, you made these statements, did you not?
If I don't recall exactly, but
you don't recall. Well, now, one of them we actually saw on video. Do you recall that one?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Well, these statements, we'll enter them for the record, and I can't imagine how you don't recall your own statements, because the American voter has seen them over and over again as you've called them stupid. Do you deny making these statements, Mr. Gruber, even though you don't recall them? Do you deny calling Obamacare a tax?
If you're reading my actual quotes, then I don't deny it. I don't have.
I am reading your actual quotes.
Then I don't deny it.
Okay. So you're not here to recant it or to deny it.
I'm here to explain that a number of those comments were made in a tone of expertise that I don't have when I was talking about political.
Mr. Gruber, do you know what a tax is? I mean, you do have, you know, expertise in economics. Do you know what a tax is?
Yes.
Okay. So you would not deny today that in these statements that you made that Obamacare is a tax, would you?
Obamacare is a large piece of legislation with many parts.
And is one of those parts a tax, Mr. Gruber?
There are some taxes in Obamacare.
Well, the President, as you know, argued that Obamacare was not a tax until it went before the U.S. Supreme Court as to whether or not Obamacare was a tax, and then the administration argued that it is a tax in order to be able to save it from being declared unconstitutional. So I would assume that you agree with the U.S. Supreme Court that Obamacare provisions include taxes, right?
The U.S. Supreme Court ruled on a particular provision of Obamacare about.
You do not disagree with them, do you?
I'm sorry?
You don't disagree with them that there are elements of Obamacare that constitute tax?
I don't agree with their conclusion about the mandate.
Excellent. Interesting. Different than what you said at these hearings. But now I have a question for you that I'd like you to think back. You said, I mean, this bill was written in a tortured way to make sure CBO did not score the individual mandate as taxes. Did you ever speak to anyone in the administration who acknowledged that to you or explained that to you, or who assigned a problem with you with the construct of that we have to draft this in a torture way so that we make sure CBO did not score the individual mandate as taxes, and you are under oath, Mr. Gruber. Did anybody in the administration have that conversation with you?
That was an inexcusable term used by
the I'm not asking you about how you believe that, whether or not you should have said that or not. It's a factual statement you're making. Did anybody in the administration ever have that conversation with you?
I do not recall anyone using the word tortured, no.
Did they have the conversation with you that it had to be drafted in a way that the CBO did not score the individual mandate as taxes? Anyone in the administration acknowledge it, explain it, or assign aspects to you within that construct?
I don't.
You are under oath.
I honestly do not recall.
Mr. Chairman, thank you.
Thank you. We now go to the gentlelady from New York, Ms. Maloney.
Thank you. Thank you. I want to remind my colleagues that passage of the Affordable Care Act was, in fact, an open and extremely transparent process. We had here in the House over 79 hearings, almost 100 hours of hearings. And prior to the Affordable Care Act, we have to remember that there were roughly 48 million Americans, including 2.6 million New Yorkers, who were uninsured. And there is even more good news coming out of New York, where insurance rates for individuals are more than 50% lower than they were before the state's marketplace plan began. And I want to say that there have been many reports that have said that the ACC contributed to the slow growth rates in national health expenditures over the past few years. The recent report from the National Health Expenditure Report showed that spending grew by just 3.6% in 2013, and that was the lowest rate of growth since 1960. So that is all good news for the American people. Dr. Gruber, I'd like to ask you, do you support the Affordable Health Care Plan? Do you believe that it's sound public policy that helps people?
Yes, I do.
Thank you. And Administrator Tavenner, I represent a large number of hospitals, and I understand that because of the Affordable Care Act, hospitals are projected to save $5.7 billion in uncompensated care costs this year alone. How has the ACA helped to save hospitals money and incentivize effective patient care?
I think the ACA has worked in a couple of ways. Obviously, to increase the number of uninsured helps hospitals from the standpoint of their bad debt and other, particularly in rural America, where they are very reliant on the number of insured in small volume markets particularly. So I think that is the first area. The second area is we have made a point of tying payment to quality. So as you know, we are paying related to whether it is hospital-acquired conditions, readmissions. We are actually having hospitals report their quality instead of paying purely for volume or per procedure. So I think those are two of the ways that it has helped. And I think hospitals in general are reporting, particularly on the for-profit side, better earnings as a result of some of these changes.
Well, many people have commented on the fact that we have the lowest rate of growth in health care costs since 1960. Can you elaborate on how the ACA is slowing down these costs? How is that happening? What is contributing to it in the past few years?
If you look at going back to the hospital issue, we have certainly seen it in terms of number of admissions and readmissions to hospital. The hospitals have growth rate has been flat, almost to the point of being negative. On the outpatient side, we have seen it in some of the growth rates around physician visits. I think in almost every area except pharmaceutical, we have seen a slowing in what has been the normal health expenditure rate.
And could you comment on the Affordable Care Act's payment and delivery reforms? And give an explanation, many people attribute that as a factor in lowering costs?
Yes. I think the biggest point that we have been able to do, starting first with hospitals, but now we have expanded it to physicians and other Part B settings, whether it is skilled nursing facilities or home health or otherwise, has been to move from a per procedure or a volume-oriented payment to a payment that is tied to quality and outcome measures. And I think that has been the biggest change.
Are the Affordable Care Act reforms an important contributing factor in improvements that have been reported in adverse drug events, falls, other complications, as well as a fall of 8% in readmission rates for Medicare patients?
Yes, it has been. Certainly there is more work to do, and we will continue to do work through the Innovation Center and through the Medicare area and Medicaid as well.
Do you believe that these reforms in Medicare to cut costs and improve quality are having a spillover effect throughout the entire health care system? And if so, how?
Yes. In fact, we actually work closely with, we try to align Medicare, Medicaid, and the private insurance market. And we work closely with issuers to make sure that physicians and hospitals are working from one set of quality criteria. So we are trying to work together.
Well, I think this is all good news for the American consumer and for health care in our country.
Thank you.
With that, we go to the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Mica.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll thank you also for your service, a great job on this committee, and it's a tough task. Ms. Tavner, when we started all of this, we had, I thought, I heard between 44 and 45 million people that were uninsured. That was just the general figure I heard. Is that what you would estimate?
I don't have that number.
Well, okay, you should have the number, particularly in your position. But we'll just say 44. I'll take the lower number.
Right.
Now, you came and you gave us some statistics last May, 7.3 million signed up, and then that was revised, and you apologized today for the error that you, at least you claim it. That's 6.9 million people, approximately. There are somewhere between 4 and 5 million people who had insurance before we had Obamacare that lost their insurance coverage. That's the estimate I've heard. Would you agree with that?
I don't know that number.
Okay. Well, again, I think you should, because this is important. The whole thing is, how many people are we covering? If we have 44 million and you had 4 or 5 million people that were insured, I'm one of the people. One reason you probably don't have more admissions is my deductible is three times as much. My premiums have gone up. The premiums, I would say, for most Americans listening or participating have gone up, unless you are involved in some other health care system. Your premiums have gone up. We have seen an exception. I have family who have had pre-existing condition, and actually I have seen what they are doing. They are gaming the system. They get the service and then they drop the care. So that's also gone down as far as admissions, one reason for less admissions and less spending. Dr. Gruber, you're one of the architects of this plan.
I was an economic
modeling. You did the modeling. You were a contractor.
Yes.
One of, I understand, about 60 contractors. What did you? What was your payment for your contract work with the HHS?
I was paid somewhat less than $400,000.
$400,000. And I heard that was a sole source contract too. Nice way to go. That was that a sole source?
I don't exactly know.
Well, did you compete, or did you have you got a sole source contract, I'm told. Okay, I'll leave it at that. You got a sole source contract according to the information I have. Nice way to go. The other thing is, then you went out to about 8 states. Did you have contracts with a number of states afterwards?
Yes, I worked with a number of states afterwards.
And I heard you got between $200,000 and $400,000 a pop from them. My estimate that I've been told by staff is you took down about $2.5 million in this.
The number,
all the money from health care, from your involvement. Again, about 8 states. Am I right?
I don't recall the exact number of states.
You can't recall. Well, again, I think it would be helpful if you could supply the committee the amount of money, and I'm told it's over $2.5 million. You're just one of the vendors. Some of them had contracts for more than $1 billion. But the whole thing gets back to people that we have that are still uninsured. We have, according to the document I got, 41 million people still don't have health care. Would you agree with that number?
I don't know which document you are referring to.
The document that we had presented to us says 41 million Americans still don't have health care. So we have covered somewhere between 3 and 4 million at billions of dollars of costs, raised most people's premiums.
I think if you look at it, outside sources, they would tell you that the uninsured rate for adults has gone down 26%.
We have over 40 million people without health insurance. This isn't a success in my estimation. I'd like to get and divide the billions of dollars we've spent on this program, the consultants who took advantage of it and enriched themselves, and we still have 40-some million people. And we can address pre-existing conditions, Mr. Goldman and Ms. Tavner, Dr. Gruber. We can also increase the age to 26 for coverage, some of the things that were done, and positive things that I think needed to be done. But do we need the bureaucracy? Do we need the people who have fed off the public trough in the billions of dollars? So one of the contractors that I looked at in a previous hearing had gotten a contract for over $1 billion, and people supposedly came to work on verifying information and never worked. So people were paid not to work. People were paid to help design the system and then profited and took the money away. To me, that's not a very good story. Yield back to Bill.
I thank the gentleman. Mr. Gruber, when you signed your truth and testimony form, you used an Exhibit B, and you didn't use our form we provided. As a result, we don't have that revenue, which is the state revenue, is essentially federal revenue. We provided grants. So would you agree to supplement your Exhibit B so that we would have on your truth and testimony your state revenue that would have also received, since ultimately it's Affordable Care Act related?
I'm sure my counsel will be happy to take that up with you.
Well, actually, I was asking, would you agree to provide it?
As I said, I'm sure that's something that you can discuss with my counsel.
So you're not agreeing to provide it?
I'm not agreeing or disagreeing. I'm saying that's something that.
Well, would you confer with your counsel, please? It's a requirement before you testify, and as we reviewed your Exhibit B, because you didn't use our form and go down it, we don't have all of your income. And since that's become a factor here, if would you please, we'll take a moment, we'll take just a short break, provide with your counsel to see whether you can affirmatively answer that.
My counsel's informed me that my disclosure is in compliance with the House Committee rules, and if there's any additional questions, he'd be happy to answer them.
Okay, we'll do some.
Mr. Chairman, can I request then that the witness provide the committee with the amount of money received from the federal government and any other health care payment that he received since the beginning?
And I apologize that this is a technical rule of the committee, folks.
Yeah. It's a simple request. Can he provide us that?
And once again, the committee is welcome to work with my counsel on that.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Jordan.
Why didn't he just tell us? How much money did you get from the state taxpayers and the federal taxpayers? He's under oath. Why didn't he tell us how much he got paid by the taxpayers?
Does he have the time?
We don't have to wait for him to send something to us. He should just be able to tell us how much did the taxpayers pay him.
Again, we have a witness under oath.
Okay, I'm going to go on to other questioning, and we will see what we can get as a further determination. But it is at this point I'm being advised that this is not an accurate and full disclosure. So we do disagree with your counsel's interpretation.
Mr. Chairman, just one,
Mr. Cummings, of
just
course,
one thing. Maybe, Mr. Chairman, during the course of this hearing, you can confer with counsel.
Yeah, and that's what I want to do. I'm going to go on with the hearing, and we'll try to do this behind the scenes, because I don't want to delay the hearing for what is proven to be. And Mr. Micah, I will seek additional time for you if we can get the information.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Norton is recognized for 5 minutes.
Excuse me. I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman, again for your friendship, for your service, and for the respect you have shown for the American citizens who live in the District of Columbia, demand to be treated as free and equal Americans, and you have always done that. I appreciate your work on this committee, very difficult committee, and I sympathize. Dr. Gruber, I accept your apology. I'm not going to question you further. Your statements invite acts of demagoguery. You will hear enough of those. I decline to participate. Ms. Travner, the $400,000 difference is trumpeted as if it were worth hiding so small an amount when the Affordable Health Care Act greatly exceeded our expectations in the numbers that would sign up. So that all I can say is if the administration was going to fudge it, I certainly hope they would not have been so amateurish. And I think the American people will understand how one could confuse people who signed up for dental care as you're just looking at people who signed up and people who signed up, period, because those were not the distinctions we were looking for at the time. Mr. Goldman, you are a constituent of mine. I appreciate that you stepped forward. I do want to say to you, the Chairman said something about cost sharing in his preface to questioning you, but you had testified that you were not being subsidized.
That's correct.
If that is the case, you are like millions of other young people who got lower cost insurance simply because you are young and not because any cost was shifted to you. That is the very nature of insurance. I'd like to ask, I note, Ms. Travner, that this hearing is taking place when we are early in the new enrollment system, period, I'm sorry. And I thank you for coming at such a busy time. You had a deputy, the principal deputy administrator, I'm sorry, not your deputy, but the principal deputy administrator, is quoted as saying the vast majority of shoppers had a positive experience with healthcare.gov. Is that your understanding? If so, that needs to be out here, given the faux pas of the first few months.
Yes, ma'am. Our second enrollment period has been much smoother, obviously, but we have been able to talk with some consumers. We've also been able to meet weekly with issuers to ask them what they're seeing from a consumer perspective as well. And so far, the enrollment process has been easy by folks' terms. I'm sure it's not perfect. We still have room for improvement.
Are you doing the kinds of customer that you can quantify? Customer experience, so that you can quantify as to what the experience has been, so you'll be able to say that at the end of this period.
We are. It's a little early because obviously we're just 3 weeks in, but we are doing surveys both through the call center and surveys through healthcare.
That'll be very important because you had such a poor start.
We will share that information.
Now, I understand that you can now handle a quarter of a million concurrent users. Is that the case?
Yes, in our testing, that is what we aspired to, and we were able to do end-to-end testing to handle that type of volume, yes.
I have some numbers here that open enrollment. In 2014, more than 1.5 million Americans submitted applications for coverage, and that 765,135 individuals selected a plan. How does that compare, if you have any figures, with the first few weeks of open enrollment in 2013?
Well, as you might remember, in the first few weeks we were dealing with a website that was far from ideal, so our numbers were very low. We are pleased with the numbers in the first 3 weeks, but I think we know by 1 year's experience that individuals will wait until deadlines to sign up. So we are looking for.
And what is that deadline, Ms. Tatum?
So the first deadline is December 15th. So this coming weekend we think will be a high volume. And then again, February 15th, when open enrollment closes for 2015.
I would like, in light of how easy it is to make errors that you will then be called on. In September, you testified before this committee, and you pledged to address at that time 22 technical recommendations that the GAO had made to improve the security of the website, and that is always a concern. Were these 22 recommendations addressed before the beginning of open enrollment this year?
Yes, they were. We completed our work on all 22 of those recommendations. And then there were six other categories, and we've completed the work in that area. Probably the only thing that is not totally complete is the operating agreement with the with OPM and with the Peace Corps. We have a contractual agreement, but we were going through a full contracting process, and that's underway.
So as of now,
I think the gentlelady's time has expired. We now go to Mr. Jordan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The ranking member said that these are just mistakes. They're just unforced errors. I think the American people would say something completely different. I would say, no, these aren't mistakes, unforced errors. This is intentional deception, and it's nothing new. If you like your plan, you can keep your plan. If you like your doctor, you can keep your doctor. Premiums are going to go down. Premiums are going to go down $2,500 on average. The website will work. The website's secure. CMS, Ms. Tavener, tells us they have 7.3 million enrollees. They forgot to count 400,000 dental plans in that number. And then we get to Mr. Gruber. Mr. Gruber testified before Congress about Obamacare and didn't disclose that he was being paid by the Obama administration. That's deception at its highest form. And then, of course, we have the videos, the now famous videos, where Mr. Gruber used taxpayer dollars to deceive taxpayers. And then when Obamacare became law, he made fun of them and insulted them. By the way, Mr. Gruber, back to the question we had a little discussion on earlier. How much were you paid, you and your institution, by the federal taxpayer and by the state taxpayer, regarding your lectures on Obamacare?
I have disclosed for the committee, as I understand from my counsel, I'm required federal payment.
I'm not asking what you disclose. I'm asking you a question. Give me a dollar amount. How much were you paid? The American taxpayer would like to know how much they paid you to deceive them and then got made fun of by the very dollars that they paid you to make fun of them. They'd like to know that. So how much were you paid?
As I said, the committee can take that up with my counsel.
So you're not going to answer the question? You're under oath? We're asking you a simple question. You come to the committee, we ask a question, you're supposed to answer the question. How much were you paid by the federal taxpayer and the state taxpayer?
As I said, the committee can take that up with my counsel and be happy to provide whatever.
All right, I got one other question.
The gentleman suspend for a moment.
Keep my time.
I want to advise everyone that the counsel has said that they're not available to clear up the errors and omissions in the gentleman's truth filing. It does require our form does require grants, contracts. In other words, we cover all revenue. We only received about $100,000, which is far less than the gentleman's testimony, in disclosures, which were three grants. As a result, the gentleman's disclosure is not complete. So I would admonish the Dr. Gruber, your choice really is answer questions fully here and then supplement, or we will seek to bring you back with the full disclosure and in order to get all the other numbers. It's really your choice. Your counsel can advise you, but we find your, by your own testimony, we find your submission deficient. And your counsel is ill-advised to say that it is sufficient because it only includes grants and you have contracts, and you've admitted under oath that you have contracts. So those are not listed and you are deficient. Again, I want to, this is our last hearing. If I don't have to recess and come back again, I would like to not have to recess and come back again. So please do not make this drag on longer. If you can give answers to best recollection, and we will accept an amendment, if that's the case, an addendum at a later date. But the gentleman is entitled to have all questions, to the best of your knowledge, answered. You took an oath saying you would tell the truth, the whole truth, not the truth and only what your counsel says is going to be discussed. It is all questions, all answers. And if Mr. Cummings were sitting in this chair or anyone else, we could expect no less. Mr. Cummings.
Mr. Chairman, I think his counsel is talking to him. Why don't we give him a second?
We'll pause.
Mr. Chairman, just on that question, I have a PolitiFact document here, and they have a fact checker thing that has all kinds of numbers. They went into this in depth as to what the gentleman was paid. And I was wondering if we just enter this in as part of the record.
We'll certainly be happy to enter in without objection.
Thank you.
The gentleman for Ohio may continue. I'd ask unanimous consent. He have additional 30 seconds without objection.
Well, I think I have a question on the table to Mr. Gruber. I'm waiting for his answer.
I was informed that I should report all Federal monies received through grants or contracts for this fiscal year and the previous two fiscal years. I did that. I have received no Federal contracts.
I don't care what you were informed, Mr. Gruber. I care about what I am asking you. And what I am asking you is how much money did the taxpayers, State or Federal, pay you to have you then lie to them? That's what I want to know.
Over this fiscal year and the previous
years? Total. I mean, look, this is this has been a 5-year ordeal with this law. We want to know how much you got from the taxpayer and then made fun of him after you got the money and lied to him.
I don't recall the total.
Well, we want that information as quick as can. Let me switch gears and Mr. Gruber, in a strange way, I kind of appreciate what you said in the videos because it seems to me for the first time someone came clean and told the truth. You told people you were actually deceiving us. So here's my one question I want to get to. Politico reported that Steve Rattner called you the man when it came to Obamacare. The Washington Post said you were the key architect of Obamacare. The New York Times said the White House lent you to Capitol Hill to help Congress draft Obamacare. They said, going up there and help those poor folks on Capitol Hill get it right. You're the expert. Go up and help those congressmen who don't know what they're doing. The President said he had, quote, stolen ideas from you to draft Obamacare. You visited the White House 21 times. You met with the President, your own words, you met with the President in the Oval Office. So I have one question. A few weeks ago when the video surfaced, what was your reaction when the President of the United States said you were just some advisor? Remember, you're the man, You're the architect, been in the White House 21 times. You go to Capitol Hill to help those poor saps get it right. President stole from your ideas. You're the key guy, and yet when the video service, the President of the United States, throws you under the bus and says you're just some random advisor, what was your reaction to that, Mr. Gruber?
My reaction was that my job was to be an advisor, and that's what I was.
Ms. Tavenner, you're currently enrolling people in the federal exchanges. How many people have you enrolled thus far in this enrollment period?
I don't have that number before me, but I can get you that number.
You don't have that number? Well, even if you did, we might not believe it based on past experience. So let me ask you this. You're familiar with the lawsuit, the court case King versus Burwell?
I am familiar with the case.
Okay. If the ruling goes against and says what Mr. Gruber said in some of those videos, that in fact those states who have not set up a state exchange can't give subsidies to their enrollees, have you been explaining to people signing up for Obamacare that, look, this all may change in a matter of months? Have you been letting people know that they might have to pay a lot more in their premiums and, in fact, have a tax liability that they don't know that they have today? You got to speak up.
Nothing has changed for consumers. They can still come in. They
no, I'm not. I'm, are you telling people things may change? We've got a court case, pretty big case.
This
fundamental
is
question. Are you telling there might be a change?
This is not a close case, pretty much plainly.
I didn't say that. I say it might be. Are you giving them a heads up that, in fact, things may change in a big way in a few months?
I'm not going to speculate about the case.
I'm not asking you to speculate. I'm asking, are you telling enrollees that things may change in a few months?
Nothing has changed for consumers, and I'm telling them
so they can get a shock, and you're not preparing them for the fourfold increase in premiums and the tax liability they may have?
I have told you consumers should come in, they should sign up, they should enroll.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, do you think, Ms. Tavenner, one last question, Mr.
Quickly.
Chairman. Do you think it's responsible to not tell the millions of enrollees who are in states that have not set up a state exchange, do you think it's at all responsible not to tell them that things may change dramatically and they'd have a tax liability and their premiums could increase as much as fourfold?
The gentleman's time has expired. The gentlelady may answer.
I'm sorry?
You may answer. Time has expired.
Thank
you. May answer.
And I have told you this is not a closed case, and I'm not going to speculate. The law is pretty clear.
I will take that as a no, you are not telling them because of the statements you just made relative to your opinion of the case. Is that right?
I have said nothing has changed for consumers. They should sign up, come in, and enroll.
Mr. Chairman, you know, if we're going to get into the court case, no one can say that would be retroactive.
Eleanor, I'm not trying to get into it. The gentleman was entitled to a no, we're not telling people, and I wanted to make it clear that when she said why she wasn't telling them, that she wasn't telling them, and I think she made that clear as to why she decided not to inform
them.
Yeah,
and I think that was a responsible thing to do. We don't know.
Well, and
I doubt that it would be retroactive.
I think the gentlelady, the time belongs to the gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Lynch. Oh, I'm sorry. Wait a second. I apologize. The gentlelady from Washington, D.C. has already gone. So, yeah, thank you. Thank you. Mr. Lynch.
Is it Mr. Clay or is it Mr. Lynch?
Mr. Clay was not noted, but if you'd like him to go first,
no,
I certainly will take him.
Oh, it's okay.
He's a delightful gentleman who has been waiting to go first for a long time.
Okay.
He looks needy.
All right. He's gonna wait.
The gentleman is recognized.
I appreciate that. Thank you. I want to thank the witnesses for attending. In my former life, I actually negotiated health care plans through collective bargaining. I was president of the Iron Workers Union, Mr. Gruber, and we're having a lot of problems in Massachusetts, in our home state, with some provisions of the Affordable Care Act, especially the so-called Cadillac tax. Now, you and I know that for a very long time, health care, until the Affordable Care Act, health care was not taxed. So when I sat down with good employers who cared about their employees, oftentimes they were more willing to give their employees an increase in their health benefits instead of putting it in their wages, because wages were taxed through the payroll tax and health care was not. So, now, as a result of negotiating for 75 years on that basis, You've got a lot of the unions across this country that have built up multi-employer health benefit plans for health care for their employees. And because these employees have, instead of taking money in their wages, they've taken money in their benefit plans, we've got most of the health care plans, these multi-employer union health care plans, are subject to this Cadillac tax today, even though it doesn't come into effect until 2018. So now what I'm seeing is that employers are running away from their health care obligations, because now they're going to be taxed a 40% tax on everything over and above the limits that have been established under the ACA. So I've got formerly good employers who now are saying, wait a minute, I'm going to get killed by this Cadillac tax. Number one, they're abandoning their responsibilities to these plans. They're trying to get out. They're trying to buy their way out. They're just reorganizing. They are, in some cases, they're cutting their companies in half so they can try to get below 50 employees so that they're not covered. They are, and new companies are not coming in to these multi-employer plans. So now I've got the unions, a lot of them who were in favor of this bill, now asking me to repeal it, vote to repeal it. They're coming to me. And I'm a union member. I'm a former union president. And I got these unions saying, repeal this thing. And now, fortunately for me, I voted against it to begin with. I voted against the Affordable Care Act because, unlike some people, I actually sat down and read it. And it was one of the most complex bills that I have ever read. And I had a full staff helping me with questions on that. So I think that this has presented a lot of problems for people who thought they were going to benefit from this plan. And how do I fix this? How do I fix this so that previously good employers who are trying to do the right thing by their employees will continue to do that? Because these construction workers, they don't work 52 weeks a year. They get laid off in between jobs. They have bad weather. They have broken time. So they needed this format to provide for their families, to get health insurance. And now these good employers are running away from their health care obligations because they see this tax coming down the road in 2018. And a lot of them are refusing to re-up on their collective bargaining agreements. They're walking away. How do we help these employees? Because now they're being told, go to the exchange. We don't do that anymore. We're out of the health care business. How do we help those folks?
Congressman Lynch, I'm not an expert on collective bargaining agreements, and I can't conjecture on that. What I can say is that the way the Cadillac tax was designed, there's no reason that these employers can't provide affordable and comprehensive insurance under the provisions of the Cadillac tax.
It's 40 for every dollar over the limit, they're paying $1.40.
But once again, given where the limit's set, there's no reason they can't provide affordable and comprehensive insurance to their employees under the Cadillac tax.
Well, wait a minute. They're competing with other employers on a bid, just so you know how this works. If we're bidding on a construction project and you have 49 employees and I have 150, my bid includes $13 an hour for health care. Your bid is zero. How do I win the bid if I'm putting, for every man hour on that job, I'm putting $13 an hour on my bid and you're putting zero on yours? How do I win? I'm out of business.
There's been a long-standing problem.
Now, you say I can afford it? How do I win that bid if my bid for every man hour on that job, I have to put $13 an hour on my bid, and you can put zero and send your people to the exchange, or you're not obligated to account for health care?
The gentleman's
how does
time
that work?
Expired. Mr. Gruber can answer.
There's been a long-standing problem of competition between employers that do and don't offer health insurance. The Affordable Care Act actually tries to address that through a free rider assessment on large employers that don't provide insurance and tries to level the playing field in that way.
Well, it doesn't do it. Thank you.
Thanks, gentlemen. And I recognize the gentleman from Utah, Mr. Chaffetz.
Thank the chairman. Mr. Gruber, you also did some work for the Congressional Budget Office, correct, the CBO?
I was on a CBO advisory council.
When did that start?
I don't exactly remember. It was probably
2007, correct?
Yeah, mid-2000s.
Yes. And how long, when did you stop working for the CBO?
I did not. I was on the advisory council until, I think, through 2008. I'm not entirely sure.
You mean 2011? Is that correct?
No, I did not go to meetings of the CBO advisory council.
Were you on the advisory council until 2011?
I honestly don't know when they took me off it, but I did not attend any meetings of that advisory
council. Were you on the CBO panel in 2010?
I did not attend any meetings of the CBO panel in 2010.
But you were part of that organization. Did you have any communications with the CBO?
Yes.
So you didn't attend any meetings, but you did have communication. How many times did you attend the, how many times since President Obama took office did you go to the White House?
I don't recall exactly.
Was it more than 20?
No, it was not.
I believe it was more than 20. How many times do you think it was? Going to the White House is a significant event. You probably remember it. So
I made a number of visits to the White House, primarily to the Executive Office Building, to meet with members of President Obama's staff.
Did you ever meet with the President?
I met with President Obama once during during the discussion.
How long was that meeting?
It was a meeting that lasted maybe an hour and a half, of which, with about 20 people, I spoke for about 5 minutes.
Was Mr. Elmendorf there?
Yes, he was.
What was your capacity in that meeting?
It was a meeting of about 6 economic experts to talk to the President and his staff about options for health care cost control.
Were you there as a CBO member or were you there as an administration member?
I was there as neither. I was there as an economic expert.
Well, somebody invited you there. You weren't. Somebody was paying you, correct?
No one paid me to be at that meeting. I was invited to be at that meeting, by the way.
We'll explore that a little bit more. Mr. Gruber, will you provide copies of all the work product you provided to the Federal Government related to the Affordable Care Act, healthcare.gov, or any other health care reform proposals?
Once again, if that's a request of the committee, they can take that up with my counsel. I'm sure that.
No. We're asking you, not your counsel. Counsel works for you. So we're asking you, under oath, will you provide this information to this committee?
Once again, if the committee can take it with my counsel, if it's a
No. Mr. Gruber, we're asking you, you've been paid by the American taxpayers. Will you or will you not provide that information to this committee?
Once again, the committee can take it up with my counsel.
Mr. Chairman, this is something we have got to get to the bottom of. I think members on both sides of this aisle should demand that those documents paid for by the American taxpayers be part of the public record. What are you hiding? Why won't you give those to us? Why are we not entitled to those?
I'm not an expert on the rules of what's disclosable and what's not, but my counsel is, and he'd be happy to talk to the committee about it.
Why will you not give us those documents?
I've not concluded one way or another in the
document. Who owns those documents? Who paid for them?
I'm not sure.
You don't know who paid for those documents? Were you paid by the American taxpayer?
I had a contract, a technical contract with HHS to do microsimulation modeling.
Was there any work product of that? Did you actually come up with documents, have discussions?
Yes, I had a large number of discussions.
Will you provide copies of all the work product you provided to the state governments related to the Affordable Care Act, state-based exchanges, or any other health care reform proposals?
Once again, the committee can take that up with my counsel.
Will you provide copies of your communication, including emails, memorandum, presentations, or any other discussions or conversations you had with Federal or State officials or employees related to the Affordable Care Act, exchanges, or other health care reform proposals?
Once again, the committee can take that up with
I need a yes or no. I'm not interested in talking to your counsel. I'm interested in talking to you right now, under oath, having been paid by the American taxpayers. Will you or will you not provide that information?
You can take that up with my counsel.
Why do you believe you are entitled to not give it to us?
I don't know the rules of how you produce documents, things like that. I'm not a lawyer. I'm just an
Do you have documents?
Do I own documents?
Do you have documents?
I have documents.
And you're not willing to give them to us?
I have all sorts of documents. I have a piece of paper in front of me. I don't understand.
Documents that relate to the questions that I just asked you, Mr. Gruber.
I have.
Do you not understand the question?
I perform grant work for the federal government. There was a work product from that work. I do not understand the rules under which that work product is supposed to be provided or not, because I'm not a lawyer, and you can take that up with my counsel.
This is terribly frustrating, Mr. Chairman. We will, I hope, get some cooperation on both sides of the aisle to pursue this. Yield back.
I thank the gentleman, and Mr. Gruber, it does appear that you have progressed in your ability to be political. You answer questions better than any politician sitting at this dais tonight, today. And it's frustrating, and I would contend that your attorney is not giving you adequate representation at this time. This committee has the right to have the information that has been requested. And you have progressed from not talking simply off the cuff and making stupid statements to now being entirely political, to the point that you are hindering us in carrying out our responsibility. I now recognize the gentleman from
Mr. Chairman. I would ask the chairman if this committee should consider a subpoena to compel the witness to provide this kind of information if he's not going to do it on a voluntary basis.
Well, I would recommend the gentleman take that up with the committee chair, whose portrait hangs behind us. I certainly would concur with you, but I'm not going to step in the place of the full committee chair at this point. I thank you, gentlemen. I now recognize the gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Connolly.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Dr. Gruber, maybe this is a good object lesson and for all academics and the consequences of sort of mouthing off and showing one's superior knowledge, especially with respect to this committee. I have long felt watching this committee in operation the last 4 years that we ought to post over the mantel on the entrance in here, you know, enter into these portals as a witness at your own peril. All of a sudden now we're talking about subpoenas and lawyers and documents and how often did you go to the White House. It has a familiar refrain in terms of how, unfortunately, witnesses have been handled, unless, of course, they're friendly witnesses who don't like the Affordable Care Act or believe the IRS has planted, you know, electrodes in their brain. And so you are getting the special treatment. And you opened the door, unfortunately, because of remarks which you have apologized for in your testimony. Is that not correct?
I apologize for the really inexcusable remarks that I made in those videos.
Thank you. The incoming chairman of this committee asked you how often you had been to the White House. How often did you go to the Romney administration offices of any kind when you were advising the Romney administration on what became really the model for Obamacare?
I don't recall exactly, dozens of times.
Dozens of times. Did you ever meet with Governor Romney?
I had one meeting with Governor Romney.
Just like you had one with Obama?
Yes.
So did that make you an intimate of the Romney administration and the architect of Romney Care in Massachusetts?
I was an economic advisor to Governor Romney just as I was to President Obama.
Thank you. And do you have documents from those years that we might want to subpoena? Let me withdraw the last part. Do you have documents from the Romney period?
Probably.
Well, I would hope, Mr. Chairman, that if we are going to have a broad subpoena suggested by my friend from North Carolina, that it be indeed broad and that we encompass all of the Romney documents Dr. Gruber was involved in, because I certainly want to see whether this is a pattern. Shouldn't be limited just to President Obama, because after all there is an antecedent, not just an antecedent. Romney Care was the model for Obamacare. Is that not true, Dr. Gruber?
I believe it's true.
I mean, for example, the tax consequences. Is it not true that right now in Massachusetts, you can be fined if you don't comply with Romney Care, and it's all run through the tax administration in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts?
It is true that if you don't have health insurance and don't meet certain exemptions in Massachusetts, you have to pay a tax penalty.
Right. And by the way, what happened to the uninsured percentage in Massachusetts? Did it go up? Did a lot of people lose their health care as predicted by the critics?
the rate of uninsured fell by about two-thirds to 3%.
3%? How many other states have a 3% uninsured rate?
Massachusetts is by far the lowest in the nation.
Lowest in the nation. Now, there were also predictions that the fines were so relatively modest that employers would be tripping over each other to divest themselves of employee-provided insurance plans and just go onto the state exchange. Did that happen in Massachusetts?
No, it did not. Employer-sponsored insurance actually rose by 10% in Massachusetts after we passed Romneycare.
Can you explain the interpretation of your statement, and I'm going to read your statement. In the law, it says if the states don't provide them, the federal backstop will. The federal government has been sort of slow in putting out its backstop, I think partly because they want to sort of squeeze the states to do it. I think what's important to remember politically is if you're a state and you don't set up an exchange, that means your citizens don't get their tax credits. Opponents of the Affordable Care Act are using these remarks to further the argument that the law does not authorize tax credits for states that did not step up their own exchanges. Is that a correct interpretation of the law and of your statement?
I don't believe it's a correct interpretation of either the law or of my statement. As I said in my opening remarks, my statement, while poorly worded and much too glib, well, I believe the point I was making was that at the time I gave that statement, which was 2012, it was not clear how effective the federal exchange would be. It was not even clear who would be in the White House to implement said federal exchange. And as a result, states might be concerned the federal exchange would not be implemented and they would have to set up their own exchange.
Do you agree, Dr. Gruber, that as written, the law makes tax credits available in every state regardless of whether the state or the federal government runs the exchange?
In every opportunity I have had to model or interpret the law, I have always made that assumption.
Yep. Mr. Chairman, my time is up. I'd like unanimous consent to enter into the record a letter from Doug Elmendorf, the head of CBO, to Chairman Issa, dated December 6, and an article by Tom Harkin, Ron Wyden, Sandy Levin, George Miller, and Henry Waxman on the Affordable Care Act and what opponents are cherry picking in terms of facts.
Without objection,
I thank the chair.
I thank the gentleman. I recognize myself for 5 minutes of questioning. It is, at least to me, it's apparent today in what we've heard, what's gone on here, that Americans now know that government transparency under this administration simply means what you see is not what you get. And that's concerning to me. Ms. Tavenner, do you believe Obamacare was crafted in a way that was transparent to the American taxpayer?
I certainly believe that the work that I've been a part of for the last 5 years has been transparent.
Was Obamacare crafted in a way to be transparent?
I was not here during the crafting of Obamacare.
Ms. Tavenner, would you say the administration is transparent in its implementation of Obamacare then? You've been here for that.
Yes, sir. I think we have tried to be transparent and we've tried to provide documents, including the documents that we sent yesterday. To date, we have already provided 135,000 pages of documents and provided more than a dozen transcribed interviews, so I think we have tried to be transparent.
But not completely.
Wherever we can, we have been
transparent. Wherever we can. Okay. Another term that could be used in this hearing, whenever we can, I don't recall, probably. Those are reoccurring terms. Mr. Gruber. The Obama administration promised the American people 37 times that if you like your plan, you can keep your plan. When you were working on the law, did you believe, Mr. Gruber, did you believe that no one would lose a plan they liked due to Obamacare?
I believe that the law would not affect the vast majority of Americans.
The vast majority? But did you believe that no one, as the President said, would lose a plan they liked?
As I said, I believe it would not affect the vast majority of Americans, but it is true that some people might have to upgrade their plans because their plans were not comprehensive as defined under the law.
So they couldn't keep their plan even if they liked it?
What the law says is there is minimum standards to be met.
Why did the President make this representation if his experts, including you, knew it was not true? That some, as you have said, would not be able to keep their plan. They would have to upgrade or they would have to change it.
I'm not a political advisor, and I have no answer to that question.
You acknowledged in a 2013 article in The New Yorker that not everyone who liked their plans could keep their plans, Mr. Gruber. When you knew that the administration's representations to the American people were false, such as in this instance, did you ever voice any concern? Why or why not?
I interpreted the administration's comments as saying that for the vast majority of Americans, this law would not affect the productive health insurance relationships they have. And so I did not see a problem with the administration's statement.
But you are an economist with a model that you described as entirely accurate. You are a learned professor, and we don't take that away from you at all. And yet the President 37 times said, if you like your plan, you can keep your plan. I am here today to say that in my constituency of almost 800,000 people, Julie Boonstra, a leukemia patient who had a plan she liked, couldn't keep that plan. And she's not stupid. She couldn't keep that plan. Mark and Kate, a young pastor and wife at a local church, now expecting, as of yesterday, cannot keep the plan they had and can't find a plan that's adequate for them to replace it. Dustin, a hardworking young man in my district, spent almost the entire weekend trying to up onto Obamacare from a plan that he lost he couldn't keep. And as of yesterday morning, I watched him try to get a plan through the website. Through talking with people connected with the website, he still couldn't get it. He had a plan he liked. He's not stupid. He couldn't keep it. Numerous constituents have contacted me saying that while they may have found a plan under Obamacare, not necessarily a plan that they liked or they could keep, but found a plan like Mr. Goldman that was reasonable in cost, yet when they got to the point of having to pay their deductibles, their co-pays, their out-of-pocket expenses, or their prescription drug costs, they couldn't afford it. And I would suggest that, again, transparency here is what you see is not what you get. My time has expired. I now recognize Mr. Cartwright for his 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I thank the witnesses for appearing today. In yet another instance of the gnashing of teeth over the Affordable Care Act. Administrator Taverner, you were not there at CMS for the crafting of Obamacare. I was not in the Congress, and many of my colleagues here on the dais were not in the Congress for the voting on the ACA. But I believe what the American public wants of us is to make the best of things, to take this law, to improve it, to make it work for everybody in the United States. And that's why it pains me to have to sit through these hearings while we criticize those who may have said something that understated or overstated the facts. To be sure, there are people who are traveling through this world and through their lives unburdened by excessive concern for the truth. And maybe, Mr. Gruber, at times in your life you have been one of them, but there is, there is a chance for repentance and renewal in life, and I hope you will take that chance, Mr. Gruber. Ms. Taverner, I want to pick up on something that Mr. Lynch was talking about, and he really didn't give you much time to respond, because we only get 5 minutes, and it took him the balance of his 5 minutes to explain a concern, and that was about the Cadillac tax. And I'm hearing about that at home as well. And I simply, this is a yes or no question, Ms. Taverner. Will you undertake to review the Cadillac tax and perhaps rethink it and engage those with whom you work to rethink it, and maybe even go back to the drawing board about the Cadillac tax in an effort, as I said, to take this law and improve it and make it work for all Americans?
I think the President has been clear in that he would be willing to work with Congress to make improvements to the law.
Well, I thank you for that. I also want to talk about cost a little bit. In an unguarded moment, the chairman of this committee listed a number of statements that he considered to be untrue or falsehoods. Some of them I agree with, but among them he listed the idea that health care spending in this nation has had the lowest increase in 50 years. I was surprised to hear him list that among statements he considered to be falsehoods. Would you comment on that, Ms. Tavenner?
I would say that based on the health care expenditure report last week that our Office of Actuary did, that that statement was not true. It is the lowest trend in health care spending that we have seen. It continues a trend that we have seen for the last several years. This year was one of the lowest for 2013 and the lowest that the health care expenditure report has on record since 1960. So I think health care expenditure is at an all-time low. There is still an increase year over year, but the expenditure and the slope of that growth has greatly slowed.
Now, there is not a whole lot refreshing to talk about when we talk about the ACA and recriminations over it, but that's one of them, isn't it?
That's one of them. I think 6.7 million Americans signed up in the marketplace is another. Over 9 million new to Medicaid and CHIP. These are all good things.
Now, in conjunction with that, you know, I've been an employer through the 1990s and the 2000 decade. We saw, and we provided health care for our employees, and we saw increases that were in the double digits, 10, 15, even 20%, even higher in some years for the premiums we were paying to cover our employees. It was awful. I was dismayed by those numbers, and it was something that hurt every year to do. What's the average increase we're looking at this year in premiums under the ACA, Ms. Tavenner?
Under the ACA, while it certainly can vary by region, we are looking at single digit, in the low single digits for increases. In the employer-sponsored insurance, separate and apart from the marketplace, 3% this year, which is, again, follows an overall extremely low trend. Certainly, there have been changes in copays and deductibles along with that, but it still is a much lower growth than we've seen in years past.
Again,
and I shared your concern for the last
more refreshing news from you. Thank you for appearing today, Ms. Tavenner, and all the witnesses. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. The gentleman yields back. I now ask unanimous consent that our colleague from South Carolina, Mr. Rice, be allowed to participate in today's hearing. Without objection, so ordered. We now go to the gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. McHenry.
Well, Dr. Gruber, you know, as everyone knows and as American people know, when the President said, if you like your plan, you can keep it, turns out it was the lie of the year, right? I mean, this is a very significant thing. And my constituents in North Carolina, and actually North Carolinians, according to the North Carolina Department of Insurance, 473,000 North Carolinians lost their health insurance because of Obamacare. So this is perplexing, right? You had a moment of clarity and honesty where you said, you know, it was a lack of transparency that helped pass Obamacare. And I concur, and I appreciate your honesty. I think it's horrific, though, that you participated in some level on obscuring the truth from the American people in order to pass this bill. Now, you apologize for that, and I thank you for that. And the American people hear you loud and clear. And as a sort of as a more matter of morality, for you to apologize is really a, I know it's a tough thing to do publicly, but I thank you for doing that. So, you know, when I think about my constituents, though, did you think that there would be such a large number of folks that would lose their health insurance?
I don't know the exact number in North Carolina, but
well, it's 473,000 according to the Department of Insurance and the Raleigh News and Observer.
What I was focused on was the net increase in newly insured we've had or have under the law, which has been quite substantial.
Okay. So it's not relevant to your calculation that there would be people that would lose their health insurance?
That was part of the calculation.
It was. So there is churn, would you say?
There's always been churn in this market.
Sure. Did you think it would be such a large number that would lose their plans, though?
I don't recall the exact numbers I modeled, but we did model that some individuals would lose their existing plans and move to new forms of coverage.
Well, I think you anticipated it. You are obviously very well prepared. I think you anticipated this question. Is it similar or dissimilar to the number that you calculated?
I don't know of a national estimate of how many people have lost health insurance, so I don't know how it compares to what I projected.
So was there a discussion at senior levels in the White House and HHS about this potential loss of people's health insurance plans?
I don't recall whether they were when I was there. I can't speak what happened when I wasn't.
So was there there was no moment of moral clarity, of honesty, that you came to publicly, that we now know about and most Americans know about? There was no discussion at the time that maybe we should put the brakes on this, that we are going to have a lot of people lose their health insurance plan, their preferred health insurance plan?
I was present for discussion. As I said, I provided numbers. I was present for discussion of those numbers and interpretation of what they meant in terms of how the law would affect individuals.
Did anyone say, well, but pause for a moment. The President's been out saying if you like your health insurance plan, you can keep it. Gosh, maybe we should tell him that that's not, in fact, the case. Maybe he should change his wording a little bit.
I was not in any discussion of presidential communication or messaging.
Okay. But in the meetings where you went through these numbers and you said to the administration, and look, you've got plenty of experience on this. You said to this administration, because you are in the employ of this administration, you said there will be people that lose their plans. Right? Now, you said there are also going to be people that get other plans, right? But you said there will be people that lose their plans. Was this not registered? Did this fall in deaf ears?
All I know is what my modeling showed and what I conveyed.
And you conveyed that there would be, in fact, people that lose their preferred health insurance plan.
I conveyed that there would be churn in the market and some people would move to different insurance plans.
So, as I said before, my interpretation of churn is that some lose and some gain. So when you have the President going out saying clearly, if you like your plan, you can keep it, it was, in fact, a lie. Based off your numbers, based off the data you provided this administration, is that correct?
I interpreted the President's statement as referring to the fact that the vast majority of Americans would be able to maintain their health insurance arrangements under the Affordable Care Act.
Okay. So you also said that, you know, the only way to pass this type of health insurance is to actually pay lip service to fundamental cost control, right? That you actually need to talk about cost control in order to pass this type of health insurance change. So was it, in fact, just lip service?
Fundamental cost control is very, very hard in health care. The Affordable Care Act does not solve the problem of high and rising health care costs in America.
It did pay lip service, though.
No, it did more than lip service. The Affordable Care Act is by far the most ambitious piece of legislation in our nation's history in terms of moving forward on cost control.
Okay. Okay. And so has it outperformed your model or underperformed your model?
My model, as with the Congressional Budget Office model, over the budget period did not.
No, I'm saying so far.
So far, the law in terms of health insurance coverage and other things has matched fairly well with what the model predicted.
Okay. So that lip service was important, in fact, to pass it.
I don't understand the question.
Okay. Well, you said in order to pass it, you have to pay lip service to fundamental cost control.
As I've said, fundamental cost control is very difficult, but the Affordable Care Act takes all the first steps that are necessary to try to move us down that path.
Okay. My time has expired.
I thank the gentleman. I ask unanimous consent to have the actual numbers, as they have been revised, placed in the record relative to the Affordable Care Act without objection, so ordered. The gentleman from Vermont, we are pleased to have you join us.
Thank you.
And you are recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. A couple of things. Number one, Mr. Gruber, you have apologized for the intemperate, you said, insulting remarks. It is unfortunate. This whole debate about health care is so fundamentally important to this country. It's been divisive in Congress. We had a partisan vote and strongly different points of view about it. And unfortunately, the remarks you made provided clear ammunition for opponents to use that to indict the entire bill. But when you start commenting about what you expect might be a legal outcome, do you have any training as a lawyer?
No, I do not.
All right. When you comment on the quality of mind of the American people, which I think all of us here have a great deal of respect for the people we represent, you would, I take it, apologize for any insulting remarks you made?
It was inexcusable that I tried to appear smarter by insulting others.
All right. And the other thing, I listen to my colleagues here and they talk about folks who had a bad experience with the health care bill, and some people have had good experience, some people have had bad experience, but it really is profoundly important to the American people that they have security about health care. And is it your view, I'm now going back to your area of expertise, that broadly speaking, the American health care system has been improved as a result of the passage of the Affordable Care Act?
Yes.
Just be specific as to a number of items that are better now than before the Affordable Care Act was passed.
The Affordable Care Act has lowered the rate of uninsurance. About 10 million people have gained health insurance, according to latest estimates. The Affordable Care Act has ended the fact that individuals face pre-existing conditions and the inability and the financial insecurity that comes from having to buy insurance on their own. And the Affordable Care Act has contributed to a historically slow rate of health care cost growth.
And is it also your opinion that the Affordable Care Act shares many things in common with what was called Romney Care in Massachusetts?
Yes, it is.
And you worked on the Massachusetts version with the Romney administration. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
And I think I heard you say that the uninsured rate in Massachusetts is about 3 to 4%.
It's fallen to, but before the Affordable Care Act, it fell to about 3%. It may be lower today.
And my understanding in the passage of the Massachusetts bill is that there actually was a bipartisan vote that supported that legislation. Is that correct?
Yes.
Which we did not, that eluded us here, unfortunately, in this Congress. Now, my view is that there's a lot of things we still have to fix in our health care system. I've never had the view that any single bill is going to be the magic fix, that it has to be an ongoing process. And I'd ask you, in the cost issue on health care is the one that I think needs even more attention. But first, I'd ask you and Ms. Tavenner, what has happened to the growth of health care spending since the passage of the Affordable Care Act? Ms. Tavenner?
I think, as we discussed earlier, it's at historic lows, 3.7%, I believe, for 2013, which is the lowest on record since 1960.
And does that apply across the board, whether a person is in the health care, in the ObamaCare, or on their own private or employer-sponsored health care?
Ms. Tavenner, would you please put the microphone closer?
Sorry. It is across the board.
All right. And Mr. Gruber, what would you, or Dr. Gruber, what would you cite as important elements in the Affordable Care Act that has helped slow the rate of growth in overall health care spending?
The Affordable Care Act took a number of steps in a wide variety of directions to try to slow spending, most notably, I think, as Minister Tavenner mentioned, changes in the way that health care providers are reimbursed, penalties on readmissions for hospitals. We have seen an enormous reduction, which has lowered costs, and really just led to some very innovative thinking on how we can fix our broken fee-for-service medical system.
And my observation is that in Vermont, where we have had an ongoing discussion about health care and still are in the midst of that, we've got health care providers, our hospitals and our doctors, that are really focused on trying to figure out better ways to treat, to curb infections, to change the billing process. But they are on the front lines. And what are some of the things that we can do to help them be successful in providing better health care at lower cost?
I think the most important thing is to continue to learn from the ongoing experiments that are going on in our nation's health care system to try to understand what is working to deliver this low rate of health care cost spending.
Ms. Tavenner?
I would agree with that. I would also say, and we have tried to do this through the Innovation Center, some upfront help in how to work with electronic health records and how to build an infrastructure that goes from fee-for-service to actually assuming risk and looking at it on a...
And accountable care organizations are part of that?
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you. I see my time is up. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. We now go to the gentleman from Oklahoma, Mr. Langford.
Good morning, y'all. I want to go through several transparency issues. Ms. Tavenner, what is the plan for states that are not self-sufficient in their oversight and their running of their exchanges by January the 1st? The law states by January 1, 2015, they have to be self-sufficient.
I think currently, I assume you are talking about the smaller states.
Yes.
And currently, they are sufficient, self-sufficient, and are obviously carrying through for 2015. We are in ongoing discussions with them.
How are you defining self-sufficient?
So, as you are aware, the funding ends. The 1311 funding will end at the end of this year. Most of them are dependent on their user fee and some other sources of revenue, and that will carry them through 15, but we will be having ongoing discussions with some of the smaller states.
The state of Vermont has had some conversations about the cost overruns that they are experiencing this year on the exchange, and they are pursuing federal grants to help make that gap for this year. Rhode Island had, even this week, there was an editorial that came out in the Providence Journal suggesting to the governor to punt this and to go back to the federal oversight because of the cost overruns there. So there is some buzz and some conversation about states and what they are going to do in 2015. My question is, the law requires that they be self-sufficient by that point. And so a twofold question on it. One is, for the states that come back to you and say, we need a grant, we need additional dollars, we need some additional help in 2015, will they get federal dollars, contrary to the law saying they must be self-sufficient?
There will not be federal dollars. Any federal dollars awarded have to be awarded by the end of 2014. So there is not a...
Could they get a larger portion given to them at the end of 2014 with the implication this is to help your shortfall this year and to help you for next year?
It is very specific what the grants can be used for, so I will be glad to get you that information.
Could it be used for 2015 spending?
So that is very specific, so I will have to get you that information. I can't answer that right now.
Well, I am just saying the law says they have to be self-sufficient by January the 1st,
right,
of 2015, if the grant is given to them and those dollars can be used after January the 1st, 2015. That is contrary to the law.
I am happy to get you that information.
I'm just asking. I am not trying to be contrarian. I'm just asking the question, is there any money being given to them that they will use after January the 1st, 2015?
I'm not trying to be contrary either. I just have to get you specific information about each state, so I can't answer that in a general question. So I'll get you that information.
Okay. Well, just the blanket response on it would be, we're definitely going to follow the law on it. We're not going to give them extra funds this year that they'll really use next year, contrary to the statute.
I'm happy to get you specific information.
Okay. Well, I will look forward to that, and we'll definitely. We'll assume that we're going to follow the law on that as it has been written out. The question that goes along with that as well, again, going back to the transparency part of this, we have the numbers for this month, the 6.7 million that have the enrollment. Will we get monthly effectuated enrollments from here on out? This is, we're a year into it. Will there be consistent snapshots month at a time?
So there, and I think this is what led to our mistake. So if you'll indulge me for a minute, let me try to explain. Effectuated enrollment are actually those individuals who have paid.
That's right.
Okay. So what we gave, the information, the 6.7 that was current, we will be able to run another effectuated enrollment toward the end of the year, which will cover 2014. So, yes, we can get you that information.
Will we just get monthly snapshots from here on out?
Well, there is really only one more month left.
Right. But I meant just after that. But the open enrollment period goes all the way through into early next year as well.
So that is 2014. So let me close 2014. And last night we sent Chairman Issa a large data dump.
A lot, and including questions that you and I had talked about in September of last year that I got the answer for at 6:30 last night.
Yes.
Finally. I appreciate that.
We try. We may be slow, but we try. The second thing has to do with 2015. And so the first time we would be able to actually look at effectuated enrollment in 2015 would probably be mid-February or late February, because remember, payments are not made until sometime in January. Those payments have to be trued up. We have to check them for accuracy, not double count dental again. Mm-hmm. So you will probably be looking at that in the spring.
So you are getting numbers on that consistently as well. We would just like to be able to get actual numbers on that. So is that every month we will get those after that? Will it be every 2 months? When will we get snapshot totals? Because we have got to get into a rhythm. Just plan selections. I went on the website, put it in the shopping cart. It's not enough.
Right. And this is where I think we will do regular intervals. We should be able to provide it to you monthly.
And what was the estimate that we hope to have by this point in the original rollout of the Affordable Care Act for effectuated enrollments for this month?
You know, that is interesting. I don't know that we ever had a publicly stated goal for enrollment for 2014.
CBO did,
CBO
obviously.
Had 7 million originally, and then they revised that downward to 6 million sometime in the spring of 14. But I don't think we ever had a public goal. We are delighted with 6.7.
The CBO number, I think, originally for the end of this year was 13 million. Is that correct?
No, I don't think that's correct.
Well,
I'd have to look at that.
10, 12, what's the guess?
So you mean for the end of 2015?
2014 or 2015?
Yes, the end of 2014, I believe, was the 7 million that was revised down to 6 million, if I remember correctly. For the end of 2015, by this time next year, I think it was 13 million.
Okay. Then if the Chairman will indulge me, one last question on it, just another transparency number, and that is the Medicaid numbers. We're trying to get accurate numbers based on the expansion that occurred, the new expanded definition of Medicaid in states that took that expansion. Will we be able to get a listing of the difference between people that enrolled in Medicaid, just enrolling in Medicaid, and those who became eligible based on the expansion?
Yes. We are actually working on that report even as we speak.
Okay. When do you think we would get that number?
Soon.
Can you define soon? I asked you questions in September, and I got them last night at 6:30. So help me define.
I might note that Congress will be going sine die soon.
Yeah. Right. I don't think we'll meet that definition of soon.
So the senator will be getting a report next year.
So help me understand soon, just so I can get a ballpark on.
So I really, it's in the process.
In geological terms of soon, or in more of a.
In geological terms of soon, I think it would be early 15.
How about a month?
About a month. That will try.
Be great.
For a month.
Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. And early on in my chairmanship, I probably should have gotten into the difference between geological, biblical, calendar soons, and I could have done so much to speed things up. We now go to the gentlelady from New Mexico.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I also want to thank you for tackling a very difficult challenge often in this committee. And while I have concerns about rollout from that are, I think, have been extended actually or not addressed as effectively as it could be from last year, I think we are all in a better place given that this is a much smoother rollout. But I want to hit, if I can, three things. One, the Affordable Care Act deals with cost not just by making some transformations to a fee-for-service environment, but just by having more people covered and lowering uninsured and uncompensated care costs. You know, we have that shift, which is great, but it didn't do enough, in my opinion, to deal with quality or cost. So we're going to have to continue to get people insured, and we're going to have to continue to deal with real cost issues and real structure issues in the way in which we reimburse providers and incentivize patients. Given that, in our state, New Mexico had one of the lowest or highest uninsured populations in the country pre-Affordable Care Act, and we are doing better, but we could do much, much better. And in fact, given our large Hispanic population, which continues to be a real challenge across the country, Ms. Taffner, can you talk to me a little bit about what you are doing better about outreach and transparency and communication and education? Because the Hispanic demographic, as I understand it, was the lowest. We didn't penetrate that population in terms of increasing coverage. So what are you doing to specifically address that?
Right. I think for starters, this is something, you're correct, we identified at the end of the open enrollment period last year that this was an area we had not penetrated as deeply as we'd wanted. So we created a work group, and we've gone about it several ways. We've created advocacy groups. We've worked with navigators and assisters to make sure that they are trained not only.
Be specific about that advocacy work. Talk to me about specifically how that would translate to somebody in New Mexico having a better chance for being enrolled.
So let me start with the navigators and assisters in New Mexico. We have done more to ensure that as we made the awards this year, that we were dealing with bilingual staff in all areas, because that's something, and not just a presence, but a significant presence. We have been working through, and I can get you information specific to your state, but we have been working with advocacy groups inside the state to work many.
I would really encourage you to do that, and I appreciate that you're trying to answer, and I want to make sure that with my limited time I get as much out as possible. I have a suggestion for you.
Okay.
I attended many of the enrollment efforts last year, and you're touching an individual consumer 6 times in New Mexico. You lost them if you have them in the room, get them enrolled. And that's a huge problem. And you're minimizing, I think, the experience that our consumer here today presented. I really appreciate your presence here, that it can and does work. Now we need to make sure that people have that opportunity. The second thing is, I really want, as you are getting more people covered, I want us to start exploring, and I'm asking for the administration to work more closely with members of Congress, because while we are seeing access and the exclusion of pre-existing conditions, having that be a barrier to providing coverage, and premiums that are lower in my state certainly, but out-of-pocket costs and deductibles are higher, which means that you still don't get folks who are accessing the health care system even if they have coverage. And while I think most folks still are not understanding that the Affordable Care Act really minimally does anything to insurance companies when we set the floor about who they have to cover, but they make decisions about their provider networks, and they make decisions about what they are going to pay docs, and they make decisions about what hospitals are going to be in their network, and they create that environment. And we are going to have to do more to get them to lower total costs and to create much more expansive provider networks. And I'm encouraging you to be very assertive in that role and work with members of Congress to get that done. And with limited seconds left, I'm going to, the last part is, like my colleague, Senator Langford, since August and September, we've been waiting for you to respond to New Mexico about behavioral health access. While that's not particularly related just to this hearing in the ACA, it is a transparency issue, and we are looking for numbers. And my understanding is that now another provider has dropped all behavioral health coverage in the southern part of the state, and I'm really encouraging you that while you wait for 3 months to respond, that's 3 months where New Mexicans don't get health care coverage in Medicaid. And I'm encouraging you to take a stronger, more productive role to stop the damage in New Mexico.
Thank you. Will do.
I thank the gentlelady. We now go to the gentleman from Arizona, Dr. Gozar.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Gruber, in your testimony you stated, I'm not a political advisor nor a politician. I like that statement. I'm a dentist by trade, impersonating politicians, so I want to commend you on that. But there's something very similar about you and me, is you're very astute to detail like me, right?
I like to think I pay attention to detail, yes.
Yeah, because the beauty is in the detail, right?
Often that is the case.
Yeah. So, did you lie about any of your comments when you publicly were, some of the aspects that we saw on television? Were those outright lies, or were they just not politically pleasant?
They were not lies.
They were not lies. So they were truthful in regards to a stalwart evaluation of a process, right?
They were, once again, my inexcusably trying to conjecture about a process about which.
No, but I want to go back to this. You weren't lying. You were very truthful about the process.
I was once again trying to.
I mean, it may not be politically savvy or, you know, like as we say, red meat. But what you were doing was you were very honest in regards to the process.
Once again, I was making statements about which I really didn't have the expertise to make. I was just speaking out of turn.
I don't know about expertise. Let's go down that. We just talked about beauty is in the detail. You're very astute about the economic aspects. You had your inclinations and models with RomneyCare. You've actually had these models with Obamacare. So you're very astute in regards to this. I mean, being from MIT, I mean, that's one of the most prestigious acclaimed environments in the world, right?
I believe so, yes.
And when you're proud of a product, you really are vested in that product. So you're going to be very watchful as it takes place, as it changes, as it morphs, and maybe as it has contradictions, right?
I was very proud and invested in the modeling and the numbers I produced, yes.
Yeah, so I'm going to go back to it. So you were very honest in your evaluation of what transpired. That, we saw the real Jonathan Gruber in there. I mean, I watched you last night for almost 4 hours on all the different aspects. I read body language extremely well. So you were in your element when you were talking about the critiques of this health care law. Let me ask you something. So who helped you with your testimony today, and who signed off on your testimony today?
No one signed off on my testimony. It's my own testimony. I did receive assistance from my counsel.
Did you also have assistance from HHS, the administration, the minority staff committee?
No, I did not.
Okay. Now, were you coached in any way what to say?
The words that are written, I said, are my own. As I said, I did work with my counsel in preparing them.
Okay. So when we had numbers of my colleagues asking you in regards to numbers, you're pretty astute with numbers, right? You know those numbers.
Once again, the numbers that I produced in terms of my microsimulation modeling, I'm very confident in.
Ms. Tavner, you're also pretty good with numbers, aren't you? I mean, I've been watching the bantering back and forth, and when the other side asks you a question, you're very prepared with numbers. But when we ask you a question, you're very inappropriately responsible to numbers. But you're very good with numbers because you hear them all day long, do you not?
I do hear numbers.
You do. I agree. So, you know, this preponderance of looking at the falling rate of dollars being spent in health care, I'm going to go back to the microcosm called dentistry. Did anybody even think about this? I mean, what kind of access, the gentlelady from New Mexico talked about access. Did that ever come into your aspect that the deductibles are so high in the dental aspect that no one's using them? Did that ever occur to you?
You know, if you look at what we did around the dental proposed and final rule last year, we actually tried to make some accommodation there to handle the deductible to improve it, if you will.
Well, that's nice. I mean, you know, changing around some of those aspects. But, you know, from my standpoint, when people don't actually get care, you're actually creating a bigger problem. You know, the gentleman from Maryland is aware of the Damani driver aspect. When people can't pay for it, it reduces access. Children go walking around without getting health care, and all of a sudden we have a child that dies. You're aware of that situation?
Yes, I'm aware of the situation that occurred.
So once again, it becomes that fluff part, you know, because I heard people on the other side over here saying this was the most transparent process. Really? It didn't involve anybody on this side, and I'm very well aware of having, you know, a bipartisan type of application to health care, because health care is a personal sport. The patient has to be involved, and it's not a Republican or Democratic issue, but it became a very Democratic issue. They used reconciliation and a lot of gimmicks to pass it. We were deceitful in everything that we've done. I mean, everything. Instead of acknowledging the problems and being truthful on it, we heard tortured language, you know, from the gentleman to your left. This was outright the wrong way to go. From that standpoint, it sickens me to actually hear what I heard today from both you and from Mr. Gruber. It's sad, you know, that we're playing with people's health care when they deserve something better. Frankly, not having the facts is disdainful. Congress has a right to those facts. We've seen this perpetually with this administration, from Fast and Furious to Benghazi, to here, to the IRS, it's disdainful. Equal branches of government should have that opportunity, and the American people deserve better from both of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Was there an answer? Okay. We now go to the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Meehan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I want to express my appreciation to you and the ranking member for your leadership of this committee over the course of the years. I want to thank the folks for being here today. I mean, I know there's a lot of characterizations of testimony and what things have gone on, and we go back and forth on this committee. I mean, I know in the end, and I think you would agree, in the end, the people we represent, the American consumers, aren't, I find to be actually quite intelligent with their efforts to try to become good consumers of health care information. And these aren't gotcha questions, but we don't get a chance to have you before us much, Ms. Tavner. And what I'm seeing out there right now is patients who are, they are the holders of their electronic health records, but they're bouncing around from system to system. I mean, they are frustrated. Their costs are rising. They aren't getting the access to the doctors they had before. They're paying more out of costs, which I think is one of the factors that's driving some of the containment of health care. But at the same time, what's happening is I think people aren't getting health care, and we're going to be paying for more down the road. But my problem is, how are we working on assuring that these systems of electronic health records can communicate through the larger structure? It seems if you're in a health system, you can do okay. They'll send records down to your doc, and you know, with this whole idea of the medical home. But if you have a surgeon outside in another network, it doesn't seem the systems are communicating with each other. Everybody's saying, use my system. What are we doing? How are you working to try to break through those adhesions so we can get to a point where we can allow consumers to be much better in helping them guide their health care and negotiate through the systems, whomever the health care provider is?
I think what you're talking about with the issue of interoperability is one of our remaining challenges. You're right. We have strong systems within a system. Physicians and hospitals tend to work together well, but when we are moving across systems, that's still a challenge. And that's part of, as we look at stage three of meaningful use, one of the big pieces that we are going to stress is this whole issue of interoperability. We have some pilots now. We have some examples. But the question is, how do we get that to the mainstream?
Do you have, I mean, can you give me some sense right now? Because that does appear to be, and I think it's going to continue to be, if we don't find a way. Because, look, people move. They're here today. My elderly will be down. They may go away for 2 or 3 months in the wintertime now to different physicians.
So I see it happening in two ways. One, obviously, is with payment strategy, because that tends to work. The second is with our certification requirements. So we'll be working with the department, with HHS and CMS, because this is kind of a two-group effort, to make sure that we put in our certifications and other requirements, those measures that will push interoperability, because I agree with you, it's critical.
And from the perspective of the patients, then, are we doing more to be able, or how are you helping us to be able to understand what they're going to face in premiums or out-of-pocket costs or provider quality in particular? How are you moving to be allowing the patient to become a better consumer?
That is, again, we spent a lot of 2014 just helping people sign up, and now the second part is, how do you educate those individuals who've signed up? So we have started work that we're doing. It started within CMS. We're now putting it more broadly out to the consumer. It's called From Coverage to Care, so helping people understand what deductibles are, what copayments are, how they one thing that's greatly misunderstood is that individuals don't pay copays and deductibles for preventive care and for other types of procedures that are preventive.
Well, certain kinds, but I mean, there's a lot of care
that they do,
and unfortunately, that's often when they're going to see the physician.
So that's how we'll start, and we'll work with issuers, we'll work with advocates to get the education out there to help people understand it. It is pretty complicated.
Well, it is complicated, and particularly for the consumers themselves. There's a lot more. I don't agree with the way the system's set up, but that is really fundamentally for working where we've got to make significant improvements, and I hope you continue to focus on that as an aspect of your direction.
We are focused on consumers. I agree with you.
Thank you.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yes.
I'm going to ask unanimous consent that the publication data mine numbers you can use be placed in the record without objection, so ordered. Ms. Tavenier, I just want to make sure I get this right. According to this article, health care costs are up, as you said, about little under 4%. But in order to get that figure, utilization is down. So the total amount of services dropped off, and the cost per services went up, meaning if you need services, they went up a lot more than 3%. The cost of service of total expenditure didn't go up as much because people are essentially not buying as much. Isn't that true?
I don't believe that's true.
Do you know that it's not true, or are you just saying that you just don't want to believe that? Maybe your staff can tell you that, in fact, this is pretty well authenticated.
Well, I'd have to see the article. I haven't seen the article.
So you don't know if, in fact, health care costs are up and utilization of services are down, particularly because people have higher out-of-pocket expenditures?
Well,
You don't know that, do you?
If you'd let me finish my sentence, what we're seeing on the inpatient side is that inpatient admissions are down, which may mean more appropriate use of services, not necessarily that it's bad.
Okay, so you know that services are, quantity of services are down, and your conjecture is that it might be a good thing.
I think it can be a good thing, yes.
Thank you. I'll accept that that's your conjecture. We now go to Mr. Gowdy for his fight.
Thank you, Mr.
Oh, I'm sorry, is the gentleman? He yielded to me. Okay, Mr. Gowdy. Oh, Mr. Amash has returned. I apologize, Mr. Gowdy. Mr. Amash is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Gowdy. I have a question for Dr. Gruber concerning tax credits. Dr. Gruber, at a conference in 2012, you said, quote, if you're a state and you don't set up an exchange, that means your citizens don't get their tax credits, end quote. That statement was consistent with other public statements you made, all of which expressed your belief that if a state refused to set up an Obamacare exchange, the citizens of that state could not qualify for Obamacare tax credits. Yet the administration has ordered the distribution of billions of dollars to persons who live in states that don't have state-run Obamacare exchanges. This executive action seems to conflict with your numerous past statements about how Obamacare works. There is a lawsuit before the Supreme Court on this issue. In your testimony this morning, you claimed that you misspoke repeatedly in your prior public statements. You say that, quote, the point I believe I was making was about the possibility that the federal government, for whatever reason, might not create a federal exchange, end quote. You further explained this morning in response to Mr. Connolly's question that you think the administration can choose whether or not to create federal exchanges in states that refuse to set up those exchanges. So if a state refuses to set up an Obamacare exchange and the federal government refuses to set up an Obamacare exchange, then citizens of that state can't receive Obamacare tax credits. Dr. Gruber, your new explanation of your previous public statements makes little sense. The law requires the federal government to create Obamacare exchanges in states that refuse to create the exchanges for themselves. Therefore, every state must have an Obamacare exchange, either set up by the state or the federal government. If that's the case, that every state must have an Obamacare exchange, what did you mean when you repeatedly said that the citizens of some states may not qualify for Obamacare tax credits? Isn't it the case, as you said previously, that people who live in states without a state-run exchange cannot receive Obamacare tax credits?
Once again, when I made those comments, I believe what I was saying was reflecting uncertainty about the implementation of a federal exchange by January 1, 2014.
Are you suggesting that the law doesn't require the federal government to set up an exchange in states that don't have exchanges?
I don't recall exactly what the law says. What I'm saying is there was certainly—
I'm sorry, you ran the economic model on Obamacare and you don't know what the law says?
In every single economic model I ran, I always assumed that exchanges would, credits would be available
regardless of whether the exchange is run by a state or the federal government. My comments in January 2012 were reflecting the uncertainty about whether those federal exchanges might be ready by January 2014.
So you were paid hundreds of thousands of dollars to run an economic model on Obamacare, and yet you were making statements that didn't reflect the actual language of Obamacare?
I made a series of statements which were really just inexcusable.
All right. Thank you.
Would the gentleman yield?
I yield back.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yes.
I just want to make sure I understand. We famously heard that you have to pass it to find out what's in it. So following up on Mr. Amash, at the time of its passage, were you aware that the language would have allowed your model not to actually be executed? In other words, that states were not going, if they chose not to, if even one state chose not to provide, the language explicitly was preventing that reimbursement, and thus you would have a different result. Were you ever given that information so you could run a revised model?
I was always modeling the availability of tax credits under the assumption they would be available in all states.
Okay. So you always modeled something that was different than the law. And, but let me just go and do one quick thing while I've got the time. You are an author, and I've purchased one of your books. In that book, Dr. Jonathan Gruber is professor of economics at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and director of the healthcare program at the National Bureau of Economic Research. He was a key architect of Massachusetts' ambitious healthcare reform effort and consulted extensively with Obama administration and Congress during the development of the Affordable Care Act. The Washington Post called him possibly the Democratic, in parentheses, party's most influential health care expert. Do you recognize that as being in your book?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And then so if you're an author, you put it in your book and you recognize it, do you stand by it?
Absolutely.
So you are, in fact, a key architect of the act in Massachusetts under Governor Romney, and that you did contribute extensively to the administration and to Congress.
I contributed an enormous amount of modeling and economic support to the administration and Congress. Yes,
it says you consulted extensively with the Obama administration and Congress during the development of the Affordable Care Act. And you quoted the Washington Post, and you stand by all of that.
I cannot stand by the Washington Post's opinion of my role in the Democratic Party, but I can certainly stand by the fact that I provided an enormous number of hours.
Well, you put it in your book, right?
I was quoting, it was a flattering quote to me, and I put it in my book, but it is their definition, not mine.
So you want to stand by something you put in a book, including the consulted extensively with the Obama administration and Congress, but now you want to distance yourself from the Washington Post?
I'm just saying it wasn't my words. I put them in quotes because they're Washington Post words.
Oh, okay. So we'll let the Washington Post credibility speak for itself. I thank you. We now go to Mr. Gowdy.
Professor Gruber, what did you mean when you said they proposed it and that passed because the American people are too stupid to understand the difference?
When I said that, I was at an academic conference being glib and, quite frankly, trying to make myself seem smart by insulting others.
Are you offering the venue as a defense for saying it or for meaning it?
I'm offering it as a defense for using inappropriate and hurtful and excusable language to express.
Well, what did you mean by too stupid to understand the difference?
Congressman, I didn't mean anything about it by it.
Well, you said it. You had to admit it.
I was once again being glib and trying to make myself seem smarter by reflecting.
Well, what did you mean when you said it was a very basic exploitation of the lack of economic understanding of the American voter? What did you mean by that?
Once again, it's another example of my inexcusable arrogance in trying to insult others to make myself seem smarter.
Well, what did you mean when you said the American people don't care about the uninsured?
Once again, that was an overstatement of trying to conjecture on political topics in which I'm not an expert.
Well, you know what, Professor Gruber, I have listened to you all morning talk about your lack of political acumen and that you're not a politician, so therefore you don't know not to call people stupid. Most of the people watching this morning aren't politicians, and they don't call people stupid. And I can't help but note, Professor Gruber, and another one of your quotes, which I'll read to you, that was politically infeasible. You remember saying that?
Yes.
So you do like to factor in the politics from time to time, don't you? And also happen to note, Professor Gruber, that usually you insult the American voter, not the American public. So you do factor in politics, don't you?
I have tried a number of occasions, pretended that I know more about politics.
Do you think not being a politician is a defense? And is that your defense this morning? I mean, I know initially you said that you offered these comments at a conference. I think you meant conferences, plural, but you said conference when you went on a very obscure television show and initially apologized for what you said were inappropriate comments. And now today your defense is that you're not a politician. Is that the best you can come up with?
The best I come up with is to really just apologize for an inexcusable. Well,
but I want to know, I mean, the pervasiveness of your quotes is so much that it has to be more than that. It has to be more than just an episodic mistake that you made. Well, here, let me keep going, see if this helps you any. What did you mean when you said you wish that you had been able to be transparent, but you'd rather have the law than not?
Once again, it was my trying to conjecture about a political process in which I'm not an expert.
Well, what did you mean when you said it was written in a tortured way to make sure the CBO didn't score the mandate as a tax?
Once again, it was using inappropriate language to try to sound impressive about something to my colleagues.
You see a trend developing here, Professor Gruber?
I don't understand the question.
It's a lot of stupid quotes you've made. That's the trend.
A lot of
you see them?
Inexcusable quotes.
Yes. Right. And again, your defense is that you're not a politician. The lack of transparency is a huge political advantage. Well, what is a non-politician doing talking about political advantages?
A non-politician is talking about political advantages to try to make himself seem smarter by conjecturing about something he doesn't really know.
So you're a professor at MIT and you're worried about not looking smart enough?
Yes.
Okay. Well, you succeeded if that was your goal. Now, I want to ask you, are you sorry? When did you realize that these comments were inappropriate? Because it took you about a year to apologize, so I'm trying to figure out if you realized sooner that they were inappropriate, or was it just the morning before you went on MSNBC that you realized that it was inappropriate? When did you realize that these comments are indefensible and inappropriate?
I honestly didn't remember making them.
You didn't remember calling your fellow citizens stupid, and you didn't remember saying that you're the only person who cares about the uninsured, that the rest of your fellow citizens don't give a damn about the uninsured? You don't remember saying that?
I don't, because they were really glib and thoughtless comments that I made.
Well, Professor Gruber, let me just tell you what it looks like from this vantage point, is that you thought that they were really pithy and really funny until the video showed up. And then even then, it took you a little while to apologize. And what I'm struggling with is whether your apology is because you said it or because you meant it. Which are you apologizing for, because you said it or because you meant it?
I didn't mean it. I'm apologizing.
All of these quotes that I just read to you, you didn't mean a single one of them. Not a one.
What I said, Congressman, is that I was using glib, thoughtless, and really inexcusable language.
You used them a lot. You used them a lot, Professor Gruber, which tends to undercut the notion that you were sorry for an episodic misstatement. I just read to you about 10. You see why people might possibly think the apology is a little disingenuous? Maybe. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman yield me just 10 seconds. Following up on Mr. Gowdy, when you made these repeated comments, these glib, inappropriate comments in an intellectual community with lots of other like-minded people, did anybody come up to you and tell you that what you were saying was inappropriate?
Not that I can recall, no.
I guess what you said was popular in that community. We now go to the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Farenthold.